Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. The first and only item on our agenda this morning is consideration of the Children, Care and Justice Scotland Bill at Stage 2, Day 1. I'd like to welcome the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise to our meeting and her supporting officials. I note that the officials seated at the table are here to support the Minister but are not able to speak in the debates on the various amendments. Members should therefore direct all of their comments or questions for the Scottish Government directly to the Minister. And before we begin in earnest today, I'd like to briefly explain the procedure we'll be following this morning for everyone that's watching and perhaps for some in the room. The amendments that have been lodged on the bill have been grouped together. There'll be one debate on each group of amendments. And I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in that group to speak to and move that amendment and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. I will then call any other members who have lodged amendments in that group. Members who have not lodged amendments in the group but who wish to speak should then catch my attention. And if Ms Dawn has not already spoken on the group, I will then invite the Minister to contribute to the debate. The debate on the group will be concluded by me inviting the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up. Okay. Most people have got this in a little sheet of paper as well. Following the debate on each group, I will check whether the member who moved the first amendment in the group wishes to press it to a vote or withdraw it. If they wish to press ahead, I will put the question on the amendment. If a member wishes to withdraw their amendment after it has been moved, they must seek the agreement of other members to do so. If any member present objects, the committee immediately moves to the vote on the amendment. I hope you're all keeping up. If any member does not want to move their amendment when called, they should say not moved. Please note that any other member present may move such an amendment. If no one moves the amendment, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. And as a reminder, only committee members are allowed to vote. Voting in any division, not substitute members today, Mr. Whitfield. Voting in any division is by a show of hands. It's important that members keep their hands clearly raised until the clerk has recorded their vote. The committee is required to indicate formally that it has considered and agreed each section of the bill, and so I will put a question on each section at the appropriate point. So now that we've covered the housekeeping matters, we can start the substantive business. Okay. So, the first one is to call Amendment 164 in the name of Martin Whitfield in a group on its own. Martin Whitfield, to move and speak to Amendment 164, please.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and it is a pleasure to take part in this stage two. And it may be beneficial that, for the purposes of just practice, if nothing else, there is only one amendment in this first group. 164 aims to highlight the importance of what I believe underpins the whole of the bill. That is that the purpose is to promote the well-being and the rights of children in the children's hearing system and the criminal justice system. This was very much reflected in the policy memorandum that was published when the bill first came into the public domain. But within the preamble as introduced, I think more clearer evidence should be made as the purpose that sits behind this bill.
Thank you very much. Is no other member looking to contribute? Can I then seek the Minister to feedback, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to Mr Whitfield. It's certainly fitting that we begin Stage 2 consideration on an amendment bringing us back to the fundamentals of why this legislation is so important. Recognising, respecting and promoting children's rights across Scotland has been and remains absolutely at the heart of this Government's vision. Just last week, the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child Bill received royal assent and became an act. We also have a shared commitment in this Parliament to keep the promise to people who have experience of Scotland's care system. Committee, there could scarcely be a more pertinent backdrop highlighting the imperative on us in this Parliament to uphold the welfare and advance the rights of Scotland's children. And I hope we can all keep these objectives at the front of our minds as we consider amendments on the specifics over the coming weeks. Regrettably, some proposed amendments lodged by opposition parties not only undermine what, until now, we understood to be cross-party commitments and points of consensus on this forward agenda, but are also regressive in terms of the current situation. However, whilst I completely understand the sentiment behind Amendment 164, and I do agree with the premise outlined by Mr Whitfield on his reason for lodging it, a purpose clause such as this is not necessary. The long title of the bill already lists the bill's purposes in more detail. The Scottish Government has been clear in the accompanying documents and in evidence too, and statements in Parliament, what this bill is all about. Those are the right places to record the bill's purpose. And the purpose clause proposed here does not work in relation to a bill of this nature. The bill itself contains almost no freestanding, self-contained provisions. Instead, it achieves what it set out to do by amending 20 other pieces of legislation. Inserting a purpose statement like this at the outset blurs the required nuances and leaves too many unanswered questions as to how it applies to those enactments. Simply put, it doesn't necessarily add anything to what is set out in the substantive amendments to those other enactments throughout the bill. And some of those other enactments already contain their own overarching statements of purpose or of general principles. So, for example, Section 23A of the Children's Scotland Act 1995 requires local authorities, when exercising functions in relation to looked after children, to have regard to the general principle that functions should be exercised in relation to children and young people in a way which is designed to safeguard, support and promote their wellbeing. Section 21 of the bill amends that act to ensure that children detained in secure accommodation by virtue of being remanded in custody or convicted of an offence are treated as looked after children. So I'm not sure how Mr Whitfield's general purpose section sit within the general principle of Section 23A. However, as I have said, these aims are clear as a matter of established government policy and action. I'm afraid I cannot support Amendment 164, and I would urge Mr Whitfield not to press it. If it is pressed, I would urge the committee to reject it.
Thank you, Minister. Martin Whitfield, can I ask you now to wind up, press or withdraw your amendment?
I'm very grateful, Convener. I'm slightly disappointed in the Minister's response to this, because almost the contradiction between the seeking the nuance that the bill contains in its amendments, but then saying that the proposed amendment would blur the overall view. What sits at the heart, I think, of anyone in Scotland should be the promotion and well-being of the rights of the children, and that's particularly so when the children come into conflict or come into contact with both the children's hearing system and the criminal justice system. So under the circumstances, I would press this motion, Convener.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. OK, the question is that Amendment 164 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? OK. We are not agreed. So there will be a division. I'll just wait till the clerks. You're ready. So those in favour of the amendment? Those in favour? OK. Four. Well, you do the counting, not me. Sorry. After the first one. Keep your hands raised. OK. OK. Those against? Well, Ms Minister doesn't vote. Hello. Are you doing it? Okay, so I just. We'll get faster at this as we go on. Okay. Okay. So. Okay, so we have four for the amendment and six against the amendment. So the amendment is not agreed. Okay, the children's hearing system, we move to the next section. Oh, apologies, this is what I have forgotten to do. my bit I've gone. The question is that section one be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, thank you. Right, the next section is the children's hearing system rights and welfare issues for the child. And so I call Amendment 165 again in the name of Martin Whitfield, grouped with amendments as shown in the grouping. Martin Whitfield to move Amendment 165 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Again, I'm very grateful, Convener. And this section obviously deals with the rights and welfare issues in the children's hearing system part of it. And there is a number of amendments that I've lodged in respect of this. And the first one simply seeks to insert rights after welfare, because following the UNCRC passage of the bill and the progress that Scotland is making with regard to children's rights, it is opportune to take the opportunity to put into legislation the fact that rights are important to us. The other amendments in my name contain a number of different amendments, and I would like to spend a short time dealing with some of them. In particular, if I turn to 170, which deals with young people with additional support needs. We have seen an increase in those young people identified with additional support needs across Scotland, and it is correct that where young people who either have a diagnosis or identify as having additional support needs without necessarily a medical diagnosis are vulnerable. And the way they interact with adult institutions, the children's hearing system in particular, means that an approach has to be taken that is very sensitive to their particular and individual needs. I've had an opportunity to meet with the government with regard to this, and I understand that there are proposals coming forward. I don't know whether the minister wants to deal with those in her own contribution, and so there may be a different position that I will take with regard to that amendment. I know that there are others who are going to consider amendments in here. I would like to take a moment to look at transition to adulthood, which is the amendment number 171 that you have before you. And again, this is to deal with that period of time when our young people are transitioning into adulthood and the levels of support that they rightly have expected during their young period start to move away. The structures that are there to advise and support and on occasions pick up tend to distance, and the purpose behind this amendment is to support that transition going forward. There are a number of other amendments that are moved by others that I may wish to seek to comment on at the appropriate period, but given the paucity of time, I'll leave it at that stage, Convener.
Thank you, Martin Whitfield. And can I now ask Miles Briggs to speak to Amendment 119 and other amendments in the group?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to members. I'd like to move Amendments 119, 112 and 121. These are probing amendments which I've brought forward through work I've been doing in Parliament around neurodevelopmental pathways. It's quite clear for Children Scotland and parents and guardians that seeking an assessment, for example, for autism doesn't then result in a pathway towards other potential assessments, for example, for ADHD. So this amendment bringing forward today would create that situation where we'd be able to see a referral for an additional assessment. And I hope this will be looked on not only within this bill, but future bills government are bringing forward to help improve that situation. I've raised with the minister previously constituent cases where, and I have permission to share this case, a mother of two boys here in Lothian received a diagnosis of autism through NHS Lothian some years back. However, she watched her boys struggle to function at school and in society for up to 6 years before taking her boys to a private assessment for ADHD. Now, both were diagnosed with both autism and ADHD and given the necessary support and medication, which has transformed their lives and their family life as well. For children in the care system, I believe we should also see that pathway developed, and I hope ministers will look towards supporting that, and happy to move these amendments in my name.
Thank you. And can I now ask Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to Amendment 172 and other amendments in the group? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. Amendment 172 in my name puts a duty on the principal reporter in such a case that he or she identifies that a child subject to proceedings has or is likely to have had a connection with a person who's carried out domestic abuse subject to section 66 subsection 2 of the 2011 Act and to refer that young person to a provider that specialises in domestic abuse support. The amendment, I believe, acknowledges the unique vulnerabilities that children in situations of domestic abuse have and that they witness, those who witness domestic abuse can suffer emotional, psychological and developmental challenges. It emphasises the need for targeted intervention delivered by appropriate professionals who are equipped to address those needs that can be borne out of the complex trauma that they face. It also, I believe, provides an opportunity for early intervention by making a touch point early in the state impact to a referral and to an approach that I believe should be replicated across legislation where appropriate. So I urge colleagues to support the amendment in my name. I'd also encourage colleagues to support the amendments in Martin Whitfield's name and in Miles Briggs' name in this group too. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Clancy. Willie Rennie to speak to Amendment 182 and other amendments in the group.
So victim support organisations have concerns relating to the ability of the children's hearing system, as currently funded, to manage an increased volume in serious offences. It's therefore important that the outcome of these cases and the impact on the persons harmed is monitored so we can have access to the necessary information to shape the system in future. So I want to monitor the outcome of referrals for the children's hearing system, which involve an offence. This includes referrals on welfare grounds, which involve offending behaviour. This would include numbers of referrals on offence grounds, offence type, outcomes, age, gender, council area. There should be engagement with the people harmed by children and victim support organisations to provide feedback on experiences. I just want to briefly comment on Pam Duncan Glancy's Amendment 172, which we will support alongside the other amendments in this group. But I think we need to make sure that the local authorities are already providing the domestic abuse support, and it shouldn't be a requirement to go to court or a children's hearing before you can access such provision. So we just want to make sure that local authorities don't set a higher bar for the access to this kind of support, but otherwise we'd support the amendment.
Thank you. No other member wishing to contribute? No? Ms Duncan Clancy?
Convener, forgive me, I missed the amendment by my colleague Willie Rennie, in which we will also support.
Thank you. Minister, can I ask you to comment?
Thank you, Convener. And I just want to let you know that this is going to be quite a lengthy response, just given the number of amendments in this group, but I will try to be as concise as possible and take each amendment in turn. The Government does have a number of concerns regarding this group of amendments. Now, Amendment 165 would change the focus of the test, which is to be applied across the scope of the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011, and would by definition imply that child's rights are to be given the same weight as their welfare. Now, we know in some cases that this simply cannot happen, as there might be an unavoidable conflict between welfare and rights. Welfare, we must remember, is the primary indicator for safeguarding children referred to the hearing system, and it has been for many years. More broadly, on the issue of rights and existing requirements, the Children's Hearing or Court will also consider the potential impact of any decision, as they already have extensive obligations under ECHR and UNCRC, and as public authorities, they must act compatibly with them. Therefore, the necessary balance of rights is already achieved under the existing provisions, and on that basis I could not support Amendment 165. Yes?
I'm very grateful for the Minister to take that intervention. I think it is right to say that where others' rights and an individual young person's welfare can clearly come into conflict, I struggle to see where a young person's own rights and their own welfare could come into a conflict, where the decision would be that the welfare should take priority over the rights. I wonder whether the Minister can expand on where she sees the potential danger of a conflict between a young person's own rights and the young person's own welfare.
I think that it's a case of that every it would be on a case-by-case basis, and every child's situation is different. Now, I probably couldn't sit here and give an example of that today, but their welfare, as we've established, welfare and rights are a different thing, and the welfare is the basis of the children's hearing. So I would be worried about putting anything else above that idea of welfare, just in case that did impact on the children's hearings. So, for example, the right to family relationships, but welfare suggests that it's not due to behaviour by the family member, so there could be issues in family conflict or... So anyway, as I say, I would be willing to discuss this further with Martin Whitfield. But this, as I say, at the moment, this is not something that I think the way it's worded, the way it could be. So we can certainly work on that. Back to amendments. We understand that Amendment 167 seeks to ensure that where decisions are being made about a child under the 2011 Act, decision makers do not discriminate against a child on any of the grounds mentioned. And while we do agree with the principle here, we do not think the amendment is necessarily workable or necessary. And to explain what is meant by discrimination and the reference characteristics is not set out in the member's amendment, which would make it impossible in practice to effectively enforce the obligations it seeks to impose. Also, there are a range of statutory duties which already apply to public authorities, including the Courts, Scottish Children's Reporters Administration and Children's Hearing Scotland, which oblige them to protect children's rights and not unlawfully discriminate. So these include non-discrimination duties and the Public Sector Equality Duty in the Equality Act 2010, the requirement under the Human Rights Act 1998 to act compatibly with ECHR rights, including Article 14 on non-discrimination, duties to act compatibly with requirements under the UNCRC Incorporation Act 2024, which would include duties in relation to non-discrimination and will come into force this summer. Now, all of these duties have been carefully framed and do not cut across the established law and principles of the children's hearing system. They preserve the ability of decision makers to recognise that it might be necessary to treat children differently on the basics of characteristics such as age. So, for example, it would only be appropriate to share information with a child who is old enough to understand it. Recognising that all children... Yes.
Thank you, Minister, for taking the intervention. And I understand that some decisions will need to be taken on the basis of how the Minister has just described it, but that is how equalities legislation in general works, where it's not about treating everybody entirely the same. It's about making sure people get equal access to various things at opportunity and are treated similarly in systems. So that, to me, represents a bit of a misunderstanding of how equalities legislation would operate.
No, I thank the member for the intervention. What I would say is I'm highlighting some sort of relevant examples, but I've already been clear that the way the amendment is worded, it's not workable. There's too much ambiguity. Recognising that all children must be treated differently while still ensuring fair treatment and the upholding of their rights is essential to a child-centred, tailored experience that supports children of different ages in the right ways, and I believe that is what the member intended. So I hope I've served some reassurance that current law and practice is sufficient to achieve this already. Decision makers are trained on equalities, discrimination and rights as part of their extensive practice requirements. In any event, the amendment potentially raises legislative competence issues given that it relates to the reserved matter of equal opportunities and may impermissibly modify the Equality Act 2010. So for all these reasons, I could not support Amendment 167. Now, on Amendment 166, members will be aware that the recent Children's Hearings for Children report included a recommendation to commence Section 3 of the 2020 Act, and the Government accepted this recommendation without qualification. While there have been obstacles to its implementation, I am advised that a request to consider what is required in court rules is now with the Rules Council in relation to UNCRC incorporation, and this will remove a key barrier to the implementation of this provision in the 2020 Act. In essence, the requirements envisioned by Section 3 will become an obligation under UNCRC. In practical terms, this provision covers the good practice already well established in the children's hearing system, and discussions have taken place with them about formalising their training and resourcing requirements. It is essential that the government was able to do this preparatory work to ensure the responsible agencies are ready. Again, I would hope that this assures the member and the committee that this work is being expedited, and our intention is to commence the section within the timescales set out in the amendment. I'm happy to provide Parliament and committee with an update on progress ahead of stage three, if that would be desirable. However, I would therefore be opposed to Amendment 166. I do not think it helpful or necessary for us to tie the commencement of an entirely separate piece of legislation here in this manner. And by tying the duty to commence Section 3 of the 2020 Act to the Royal Assent of this Bill, it would probably be unworkable in practice. Now, moving to Amendment 170. While, again, I also appreciate the intention here, we must be clear that all children that are referred to the Children's Reporter are, in some way or another, vulnerable, and it is unhelpful to attempt a definition in this way. Now, taking into account the whole circumstances of a child's life is at the heart of the welfare-based approach adopted by the system. And by labelling some children as inherently vulnerable by virtue of certain characteristics, we risk creating a two-tier approach. Now, this amendment risks minimising consideration of other factors that might make a child vulnerable while legislating for certain characteristics that may not. Now, furthermore, the amendment does not take account of the fact that children's hearings in the courts are decision-making forums. It's not their role to provide support service. This is the responsibility of public authorities. Now, where particular ongoing support services are required, panel members may make a compulsory supervision order, which requires that others provide those services to the child. But that is a decision for the panel as an independent tribunal. This amendment would cut across that independence by enforcing provision of enhanced support to certain children, whether it was deemed necessary or not. Where additional support is required for a child to attend and effectively participate in their hearing, the Scottish Children's Reporter Administration enables this to be in place. So, for example, Scottish SCRA has a network of neurodiversity champions working across all frontline localities. Members of the network are available to assist staff in ensuring that arrangements for hearings in court are tailored to suit individual needs. They can arrange for translation and interpretation services where they are required. All children's reporters receive training on domestic abuse, delivered in conjunction with Scottish Women's Aid, and SCRA are in the process of training all staff in trauma-informed practice. It should also be noted that in 2020, the Scottish Government introduced independent advocacy services available to any child who needs to attend a hearing. Advocacy workers can enable a child's effective participation in a hearing and ensure their views are communicated to decision makers. While it is not in the role of the hearing to provide support services, I do understand the sentiment behind this. And again, if Mr Whitfield does not press Amendment 170, I am more than happy to engage with him ahead of Stage 3 on this.
Martin Whitfield, can I...
Sorry, I've still got a lot to go.
You're clearly not allowed to take much of a breath, Minister.
No, just needed some water.
I appreciate that Amendment 171 intends to mitigate against concerns about 16 and 17-year-olds as they transition to adulthood. However, the government does have issues with this. As noted in the policy memorandum for the bill, it is desirable to smooth the transition for supports available to children as they move into adulthood. And this is particularly relevant where a child has required statutory intervention on a compulsory basis. This is why, at introduction, the bill made provision to ensure local authority has a duty to provide support should the hearing decide that ongoing supervision and guidance is likely to be helpful to the young person whose order will be terminated. Now, if the young person is in agreement, the local authority will continue the relationship without compulsion on the young person up to age 19. This makes appropriate provision to ensure the young person does not fall through the cracks, as they will already be known to the local authority. I think this strikes the right balance by allowing a children's hearing to place duties on local authorities to provide support for children who have required compulsory supervision measures when their order is no longer needed or has to be terminated due to the age of the child. Now, I recognise the member may think that Amendment 171 could fill a gap for older children referred to a hearing when an order is not made. However, the principal reporter must consider a child's case in these instances, and in doing so may make a determination for voluntary support and guidance as needed. It should also be noted that Amendment 171 does not define the term transition to adulthood. In practice, this will mean different things to different young people. It will be achieved in various different ways and through varying timescales from child to child. As such, I would not be able to support Amendment 171. While I am also sympathetic to the sentiment behind Amendments 119, 120 and 121, which I think is well placed, there are a number of issues with the proposals to legislate for particular medical assessments, but I thank Miles Briggs for his contribution and the account that you provided this morning. Firstly, we must be again mindful that children's hearings are decision-making forums rather than having responsibility for ensuring the assessment of children with identified medical and neurological needs. Secondly, the responsibility to provide relevant, timely and appropriate information to inform decision-making by a children's hearing lies with authorities who work within the hearing system, such as social work, health or education authorities. Thirdly, there are existing well-established mechanisms under Part 6 of the Children's Hearing Scotland Act to request further relevant information where necessary and appropriate to inform decision-making. Moreover, these mechanisms are not prescriptive and, in contrast to the scope of these amendments, allow for a range of circumstances which are relevant to the case at hand. The additional duties may also inadvertently cut across medical expertise, which has determined that existing diagnoses are not relevant or that further assessments are not necessary. This, in turn, may delay decision-making or subject a child to medical examination or assessment, which is neither relevant nor appropriate to inform decision-making by a children's hearing. It is, of course, correct to say that we are now more aware than ever of issues of neurodivergency, and I want to be clear that the Government is fully committed to children with additional needs being appropriately supported in the hearing system. But that does not necessarily require additional specific legislative duties on a children's hearings to ensure they are considered, nor should we place an additional statutory duty on the children's hearings or the courts where it may not be relevant to circumstances of a case or the circumstances of a decision by a hearing or court. So on that basis, I ask the member to withdraw the amendments, and if not, I would ask the committee to vote against. Turning now to Amendment 172, again, I am in full agreement with the member about the fundamental principle of ensuring appropriate and timely access to support services in cases of domestic abuse. However, I don't necessarily agree that placing a duty on the principal reporter to ensure appropriate referral and access to providers in domestic abuse support is the right way forward. Ensuring that those involved at any stage of the children's hearing process have access to specialist services at the earliest possible stage of proceedings is, of course, the right way forward. But I'm not convinced that we should legislate as suggested. And in common with my comments about Amendment 170, where I said it's not the role of the hearing to provide support services, I similarly don't see it as the role of the reporter to make a determination about a referral to support services. Yes.
So whose role would it be then to make sure that the person did get referred to those services?
The children's hearing wouldn't be the first contact that somebody in trouble or somebody experiencing that would have. As I say, it wouldn't be their first point of contact for services. So that would come for others, whether that was social work, whether that was the local authority, whether there are other. Again, similar to the comments that I made on Amendment 170, it's just not the role of the principal reporter to assign those services. The key requirement instead is to ensure that appropriate support services are available and accessible. And as I say, that's not within the gift necessarily of the principal reporter. So I think it's also unclear how we would define specialist services and the consistency of provision required. So again, I would ask the committee not to support this amendment.
On that point?
Yeah, that's fine.
I thank the Minister for doing so. Would the Minister be willing at stage three to discuss the final point that she made there around which services and how to define them? And if that were the case, I would consider not pressing. If the Minister's not intending on working with me between now and stage three, then I may press.
I would certainly be happy to discuss the matter further with you, with the member.
Okay.
Amendment 177 includes a very broad range of conditions for considering, monitoring and review if a child is not in need of compulsory measures. Now, I am very conscious that this amendment would likely apply to virtually any child referred. However, this doesn't mean we need to legislate for further intervention or monitoring where a hearing reached this conclusion. Local authorities already provide support and guidance to children and their families on a voluntary basis. Amendment 177 won't change or enhance that. To act as prescribed in the amendment could potentially result in disproportionate and unnecessary interference with the child's rights. The principle of minimum intervention, only making children subject to compulsory measures where this is absolutely necessary, is a key aspect of the children's hearing system. Ensuring that services and supports are available to children, young people and adults who require these has similarly been a long-standing requirement of Scottish statute. Now, our recent commitments in the responding to the promise and the hearings for children report will go further in this area if necessary, following engagement and consultation with key stakeholders. On this basis, I would not, therefore, again be able to support Amendment 177. Now, finally, regarding Amendment 182, the committee and members should be aware that there is already significant amounts of data broken into numerous categories available through the online dashboard provided by the Scottish Children's Reporter Administration. They also publish an annual in-depth, detailed analysis of their statistics, which includes data on many of the categories in Amendment 182. We don't necessarily believe that additional legislation is required. However, I do think there's merit in further exploration of what additional material could be published as part of the annual reporting. So I'm therefore happy to discuss with Willie Rennie and with any other members who might have an interest in this area ahead of Stage 3 and liaise with the authorities to understand the opportunities and the challenges this may present. So I therefore ask the member not to press Amendment 182 to allow those discussions to happen. In summary, I would ask members not to press amendments 165, 167, 166, 170, 171, 119, 120, 121, 172, 177, 182. If they are pressed, I ask the committee to reject them.
Martin Whitfield, to wind up, press or withdraw your amendment 165, please.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and can I thank the Minister for what I think was a very constructive contribution about a number of the matters which have highlighted areas where both those who take an interest in this bill within this place but also those outside of this place have raised issues. And I'm content on the undertaking from the Minister not to move the majority of the amendments in my name, which I'll identify for the purposes in a moment. I am concerned about 167, which is the discrimination amendment. I'm not sure it can be the case that this amendment could run the risk of infringing on reserved matters with regard to discrimination. And I do think that the argument that the Minister has put forward about, in part, that this is covered elsewhere and there is an obligation on various people that come into contact with young people to apply the rules, not apply the rules, but to be very sensitive with regard to a non-discrimination process, but then not to herald or actually say that that should underpin the process that we're creating here, because this is the beginning of a move with regard in particular to children's hearings. I heard the Minister with regard to the view not to support this amendment, but in an attempt to perhaps reach out, would the Minister be content to also discuss this and whether it returns in a different form at Stage 3? Because I am conscious of the importance of non-discrimination and the fact that it's not about treating everyone the same. It is about allowing people to have a process where they are supported, where their individuality is measured and accredited by those that, as the Minister has said, effectively make judgment on people. If that's the case, then I will not be moving the amendments in my name, but I'll address them at each point.
I was about to say yes, if we can take them in turn, Mr. Whitfield, don't want me to get lose track of where we are. Okay, so can I confirm that the member wishes to withdraw their amendment?
167.
Just 165. We'll take them in turn as they come through
That's fine.
On the list.
So we'll just...
And does any member object to the withdrawal? Okay, if there is no objection, the amendment is therefore withdrawn. Thank you. So, we'll move now to the children's hearing system and victims. And can I call Amendment 2 in the name of Ros McCall, group with amendments as shown in the grouping?
Thank you, Convener.
I need to say sorry, my fault, Ms McCall. Ros McCall to move Amendment 2 and speak to all amendments in the group. Thank you. Apologies.
No, my apologies, Convener. I'm way too eager. Thank you very much indeed. And thank you very much to be here today. These amendments seek to strengthen the rights of victims, not to take away from the process within the bill for change towards young offenders. If we accept the premise that young people who cause harm are in themselves victims of harm and therefore traumatised, we must also accept that victims, especially young victims, will most likely be from a similar background and equally traumatised. And it's essential that changes to the children hearing system are set up to accommodate a balance. So 2, 4, 5, 6, 12 and 14 are amendments to put forward a consideration for young victims that is equally important and should also be at the centre of a child-based process. The purpose of the amendments is to ensure that victims are afforded protections that are given through a court process to ensure their safety and is to ensure the rights of all children involved are articulated to them within the process. I haven't got a long speech to make because I know that we've got a lot of amendments and I know that time is short, but that is my comments to the amendments. Thank you, Convener.
Can I just remind, time isn't short, so if members do want to get into depth, it's fine. We have plenty of time to scrutinise these amendments, but thank you very much for that, Ms McCall. Can I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to Amendment 168 and other amendments in that grouping, please?
Thank you, Convener. There are a number of amendments in my name in this group, and they focus on the importance of actively engaging with and considering the views of victims, recognising the impact on them of behaviour that has led to proceedings and taking their safety into consideration when discharging the duties of the panel and the disposals. These amendments seek to ensure a fair and responsible legal framework which aligns with the principles of justice, which respects the rights of victims, acknowledges their potential vulnerability and the need to safeguard their well-being. In short, I believe it balances the Article 39 rights on rehab and Article 12 rights on the right of the child to be heard. A balance must be struck to ensure that the bill and processes within it will create and remain within children's rights, and in particular the UNCRC. And so with that in mind, the amendments in my name seek to strike that balance by recognising they both satisfy the victim's right to information and also safeguarding the best interests of the child. Amendment 168 makes provision for the panel or the sheriff to, insofar as is practical, allow the victim the opportunity to express their views and have regard to those views when making a decision on whether to impose either a movement restriction condition or a compulsory supervision order. Amendment 173 looks to incorporate the impact on victims into the process by saying that when imposing a compulsory supervision order, the concerns and the safety of the person affected must be taken into consideration. Amendment 178 speaks to the safety of victims by making provision to expand the information that a victim is entitled to request to include whether a compulsory supervision order has been issued, and if so, the conditions of that order and how they are to be enforced. Amendment 180 allows for the victim to be notified if such an order is not complied with or any review that is carried out on it as a result, and also the outcomes of that review. Amendment 175 ensures the victims can be informed when such an order includes a movement restriction condition and the arrangement specified by that condition. My amendment, unlike some of the other amendments that have been put forward by colleagues, I believe allows for the information to be withheld on the basis that sharing it could be detrimental to the best interests of the child who is subject to the condition. Amendment 181 requires Scottish ministers to establish a single point of contact for the sharing of information with victims, and crucially that that be done in the affirmative procedure. I also would just like to note that I agree with a lot of the amendment 122 in my colleague Willie Rennie's name, because it suggests a similar system. I'm reticent about it slightly, though, because I'm concerned that Section 2A(1) disregards any major consideration in the, on the rights of the welfare of the child. So I'll be listening carefully to the discussion on that. I've also put my name in support of Ros McCall's amendment number 4, which adds a clear provision for a compulsory supervision order to specifically prohibit the child subject to the order from entering the home, workplace or place of education of the victim of their offences. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ms Duncan-Clancy. Can I ask Martin Whitfield now to speak to Amendment 174 and other amendments in the group, please.
I'm very grateful, Convener. There are three amendments in this group that my name attaches to, and two cover a very similar situation, which is 174 and 176, and it's seeking to add the victim into the consideration when an MRC or a CSO is made. And the final amendment in my name, 184, relates to the procedural rules, which again talks to the role that the victim should, well, not the victim should play, but the responsibility to take into account the victim's needs when decision making is taking place. We've heard a lot about transparency. We've heard a lot about the role of the children's hearings making decisions. It is important that those that are closest to it but not immediately involved in the decision making are aware and that their needs are taken into account when those decisions are made. I'm grateful to you.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. Can I now ask the Minister to speak to Amendment 13 and other amendments in the group, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener. And again, I'll just say this is quite a lengthy grouping, so my speaking notes are quite lengthy. Since its inception, the children's hearing system has been a welfare-based system focused on the needs of the referred child and not a criminal justice system. Any children referred to are referred to for the sole purpose of considering the necessity of compulsory state intervention in their lives to safeguard and promote their welfare throughout their childhood. Now, Section 1 of the Bill will enable the children's hearing system to consider the needs of any child under 18 who is referred to it. The changes under Section 1 to ensure consistency of approach for all children up to age of 18 do not require any additional direction to the hearing members on how to make decisions. The specifics of what measures are put on a child's compulsory order can continue to be tailored to the particular circumstances of the child. Now, in relation to Ros McCall's Amendment 2, the hearing system is generally focused on the welfare of the referred child, and in the majority of cases, their welfare is the paramount consideration. However, Section 26 of the Children's Hearings Scotland Act already recognises that in some cases the child's welfare has to be considered alongside other factors, specifically where a decision is necessary to protect members of the public from serious harm. Now, I consider the existing law already strikes the right balance to enable a hearing to make appropriate decisions to support both the referred child and the wider public. I do not support Ms McCall's Amendment 2, which would have the effect of lowering the threshold in some cases, tipping the balance too far from the referred child, and indeed be in conflict with the existing tests carefully designed to protect members of the public. Although disposals in such a welfare-based system are interventions with consequences on a child's life, they are not punitive in the manner of the criminal justice system, and I think it would be of great concern if the hearing system evolved into a criminal justice system for children. I therefore believe I must resist amendments which diminish the decision-making focus on the need of the child who has been referred. Turning now to Amendments 168 and 184 regarding the views of victims in relation to children's hearings decisions. These amendments appear to place victim impact type measures into the children's hearing system and fundamentally misconstrue again its welfare based approach. We must remember that the Lord Advocate retains responsibility for prosecutorial decisions, and any child referred to a hearing on offence grounds will have undergone process in line with the Lord Advocate's guidelines and prosecution policy. There will therefore already have been consideration on whether the child's offending merits a prosecutorial or a welfare-based approach. It would not be appropriate for a hearing to be required to gather the views of victims in this way and to take this account into account in making their decision. The hearing's focus must be through the lens of considering what compulsory measures are necessary to safeguard and promote the referred child's welfare. In so doing, it can include any measure necessary to prevent the child from causing any harm to others. And to change the ethos of the... Yes, Mr. Whitfield.
I didn't mean to cut the Minister off mid-sentence. On that point, is the challenge not the case then where you have a victim who is within the children's hearing system through one part of the referral, where that victim's welfare will be taken into account, but a victim who doesn't happen to be part of the children's hearing system because of the circumstances of the individual referral to it will go unheard?
I'm sorry, Mr. Whitfield, I don't follow.
Let me try and paint a scenario not based on reality or anything, but if you have two young people who've been involved in a criminal offence or a series of criminal offences, minor criminal offences, it is likely that both those young people who would come before the children's hearing. If one of those events had been a fight between the two, a falling out where one is injured, then you will have both a victim and, in old-fashioned language, and I don't mean to use this about children's hearing, but an accused. So those two children play both a dual role of someone that the welfare is being looked at, but also a victim. Inherently, the children's hearing system must hear from the young person who is both a victim and potentially involved in an outcome. But that's only because of the circumstances of the event, not because they were a victim to an offence, which means a children's panel will take it into account simply because of the circumstances they are in front of them. How is that equitable for someone who has not been involved, is not drawn into the children's hearing system as a victim, but goes unheard?
And we'll get onto it later. Obviously, there's been a lot of discussions around the rights of victims, and that's something that, as I say, I'll certainly get onto later. I think there will be a range of support for victims, not necessarily the victims or children who are at the heart of the welfare of the children's hearing system, but there will be a range of support available for those children who have experienced something like that. In terms of their views being sought or impacting on the decision of the children's hearing system, I just feel like that takes us too far in turning the children's hearing system into essentially a mini-court setting. I think that as long as we ensure that the child at the heart of the hearing is being appropriately supported and those measures are in place for them, and equally any victim, and obviously you gave me two examples there, one where one is involved in the hearing system and one out with, but even for that young person out with, the victim out with, they would have, as I say, and we'll get onto it later, a range of support measures available to them, but not necessarily to have their views taken into account in the children's hearing, because I don't necessarily see how that is congruent with a welfare-based system that is trying to ensure the welfare of the child at the heart of the system. So I hope that helps. Yes.
I appreciate this. This is lengthy, but particularly Amendment 168 doesn't... I don't see how taking into consideration a victim's views on this point... It's only taken into consideration in terms of the discharge available to the panel. I don't see how that really does detract from a welfare-based approach.
Well, I would say we've already discussed how the panel are trained in trauma, are trained in numerous different things to understand what could potentially be best for a child at the heart of the welfare system. And I'm sorry, but I just don't see how the views of a witness, the views of the victim, could be relevant to the child at the heart of the system's welfare. Obviously, the views of the victim are extremely relevant in terms of their own situation, but not in terms of the decisions that are made for the child at the heart of the hearing system. And I really don't think I can be any clearer than that.
Carry on, please.
Thank you, convener. Now, as I've said, to change the ethos of the hearing system in the manner outlined in Amendments 168 and 184 would really undermine its principles and move towards a court-type system. In addition, it would be difficult in practice, in the context of a children's hearing, to be able to seek views of a victim without causing delay to the progress of the child's case, taking the focus away from decisions being made as quickly as possible to safeguard and promote welfare. I'll now move on to address Amendments 4, 5, 6, 173, 174 and 176 on measures and CSOs to protect victims. The Bill itself already includes two new prohibitions in Section 3, amending Section 83 of the 2011 Act, giving children's hearings greater choice when deciding on which measure or combination of measures is necessary to assist the child in refraining from negative behaviours. Now, in relation to Amendment 6, this amendment is not necessary. Hearings are already required to consider whether or not a direction regulating contact is necessary, and this amendment, which seeks to prevent on a blanket basis any contact between a child and a person affected by their offence or behaviour, is not consistent with the child-centred approach of the hearing system and might not be compliant within UNCRC or ECHR in a particular case. Likewise, Amendment 173 again is not necessary for the purpose of making the order specific to the circumstances of the offence or to the safety of the person affected. The hearing already requires to consider the consequences of a child's offences or behaviour. The children's hearing in every case must already consider the established facts of grounds of referral, which for an offence ground would include the details of an offence. The disposals open to a hearing range from discharging a referral to home supervision to deprivation of liberty. So it's evident that hearings decision making already takes into account that a measure may be needed to address safety of others in response to the circumstances of an offence. Amendments 4 and 5 are also not required because the section to which these amendments relate has been worded in a general way deliberately to align with the existing Section 83 and would cover victims and places they attend. So I would ask that Amendments 4 and 5 by Ms McCall, which seem to be designed to clarify what is meant by person, are not moved as they do not seem to add anything that is missing. However, again, if Ms McCall is minded to withdraw them, I'd be happy to discuss an alternative wording or form for Stage 3. Similarly, I do not consider that the similar adjustments to the provisions in relation to Sections 4 and 5 of the Bill by Amendments 174 and 176 as proposed by Martin Whitfield to be necessary. The tests for an MRC and secure accommodation authorisation are clear insofar as they apply where a referred child is likely to cause physical or psychological harm to another person. And an ordinary reading of the word person undoubtedly includes any person harmed by the referred child. So I wonder again if Mr Whitfield would be minded to withdraw these amendments, but I'm more than happy to explore these matters further in advance of Stage 3. I next address Amendments 12, 13, 14, 15, 175 and 180 concerning the provision of information to victims, which I appreciate has been highlighted throughout the Stage 1 process. Now, in relation to the Government Amendments 13 and 15, these extend the existing powers of the Principal Reporter to share information under Section 179C of the 2011 Act. These amendments will mean that a victim can, except in limited circumstances, receive details about relevant measures that a hearing has made in a compulsory order which has the effect of prohibiting contact between them and the referred child, including further details from review hearings when a measure is continued, varied or terminated, and this will include movement restriction conditions. In addition, if a hearing considering a child's case concerning an offence or harmful behaviour makes a decision to make a secure care authorisation, that can similarly be shared. To support victims in their understanding of a hearing decision, I consider it necessary to develop regulations to improve support for victims to understand these decisions, and I will mention them shortly when I'm discussing Amendment 17. On Amendments 12 and 14, these amendments would risk information being shared with a victim that could be detrimental to the referred child or a child other than the child victim in the case. It also would remove the discretion of the reporter not to share in other circumstances where doing so could be inappropriate, for example, where to do so would adversely affect an adult victim. The Bill and the Amendments 13 and 15 I have tabled extend the provision of information to victims, and there is no intention to restrict the sharing of information except in the limited circumstances that are already set out and well understood in Section 179C of the 2011 Act. Now, whilst used rarely, I understand from SCRA that it is sometimes necessary to withhold information in cases where there is a concern about the safety or welfare of any child, including the referred child, if the information was provided, and also if they have concerns about how the information will be used by the victim or the victim's family. There are examples where information has been circulated through social media or through local campaigns against some children who have been subject to hearings. So these exceptions are necessary, albeit I expect them to be used in extremely isolated cases. The government's amendments 13 and 15, if agreed to, and which I have had very, very positive engagement about with victims' organisations, will adequately address the matters raised through Ms Duncan Glancy's amendments 175, 178 and 180. In effect, amendments 13 and 15 will ensure that if a victim is named in a child's order, then they will be told about it. If the child is on a movement restriction condition and is not to approach them, they will be told. If the measure is terminated at review or varied or continued, they will be told. Once the child attains the age of 18 and the order naming them is terminated, they will be informed. So this, together with the support services, which I will outline shortly, will give them the information they need to understand what measures are in place and when they end. I would therefore ask Ms Duncan Glancy not to press her amendments at this time. However, if there are other areas that she still remains concerned about, I'm more than happy again to discuss these ahead of Stage 3. I'll turn now to Government Amendment 17. I'm aware that the balance of rights surrounding the children's hearing system has been a key theme of debate through scrutiny of this bill to date. Now, the committee has heard some very powerful testimony on the effects of a child's offending behaviour can have on those who are harmed, and the Scottish Government is committed to ensuring victims are treated with compassion, that their trauma is recognised and that they are supported. Now, the consultation on the proposals in this bill, before the legislation was introduced to Parliament, asked if a single point of contact should offer support for a person who has been harmed. Now, this was supported by 97% of respondents, and I'm also aware that Recommendation 287 of the Committee's Stage 1 report endorsed provision of such a service. The Scottish Government always intended to support provision of this kind for commencement of the legislation, and it does not strictly require a statutory duty to ensure it is provided. This can be done administratively. However, Convener, I have listened carefully to the very strong views and the strength of feeling on this matter, and as such, Government Amendment 17 places a direct duty on Scottish ministers to provide a support service which is not restricted to a single point of contact. This would be done via secondary legislation. It's been drafted deliberately to avoid being overly prescriptive at this point, so as to build in maximum flexibility for the development of the service in the future.
On that point?
Yes.
Thank you. And I appreciate the explanation that she's given around amendment number 17. Would there be any scope at stage 3 to consider using the affirmative procedure within Amendment 17 instead of the negative procedure to give more scrutiny for parliamentarians for that piece of regulation?
If the member doesn't mind, that's in my what I'm about to say, so I'll get on to that as I speak. I've lost my place. It's been drafted deliberately. Yeah. So it also, the single point of contact also contains detail on the persons that such a service would apply to, what may be provided in terms of such support, and a non-exhaustive list of statutory consultees. The government has had in-depth discussions with victim support organisations which have helped inform this amendment, and I also thank the committee for the alteration to the Stage 2 deadline, which has allowed much more room for discussion on this topic. I think we can all agree that qualitative research would be welcome in this area to ensure that we're maximising within the confines of the law what is helpful for persons reporting offences by children whose situations are dealt with by the hearing system. Now, work has already begun between SCRE and Victim Support Scotland on a research proposal with interim reports planned for autumn, and this will look at gaining an increased understanding of how the victim information system within SCRE is used and by whom, understanding the experiences and the needs of victims, understanding the experiences and needs of the children who have harmed others, understanding models of victim information and support provision, and identifying whether SCRE's victim information service should move from an opt-in to an opt-out service. Research has been scoped and will start in February 2024 interim report to report in July to October this year. A full report is expected in February 2025. This work merits meaningful research, as the committee can appreciate, and to be done properly will take time. Now, I'm conscious that there are similarities with my Amendment 17 and Amendments 122 and 181 as lodged by Willie Rennie and Pam Duncan-Glancy, respectively, and I'd first like to highlight some particular aspects in relation to 122 and why my preference is to pursue the SG Amendment 17. Firstly, Amendment 122 is restricted to information sharing and does not extend to other support services for victims and is less flexible than the Scottish Government Amendment 17. Secondly, some of the specifics of Amendment 122 go beyond what would be appropriate to share with victims in some elements. So, for example, I'm concerned that these could potentially enable sharing of information to the detriment of a child's welfare and privacy. Thirdly, Amendment 122 could also result in sharing of information in a situation where a child moves from secure care to prison, which is not a disposal that can happen in the hearing system. And finally, Amendment 122 would also have the effect of imposing an opt-out service on victims, meaning they will receive information about decisions made about a referred child unless they take action to stop it. SCRA and Victim Support Scotland are, as I've highlighted, working together on that research project, which will consider the current opt-in service and whether there is any need for change, engaging with those with lived experience of the service provided. And I think it would be prudent to await the results of that study before effecting any change. I'm happy to engage with the member on the detail of my amendment further, if that would be helpful at all, particularly to reassure him that what Amendment 17 will achieve will be more beneficial to victims. And I should highlight that the regulation making duty through Amendment 17 will also require prior consultation and engagement, including with victim support organisations. Now, Amendment 181 from Ms Duncan-Glancy has similar aims to Amendment 17, but is restricted to a simple single point of contact provision. Now, Amendment 181 does, however, prescribe regulations subject to affirmative procedure rather than the negative procedure outlined in Amendment 17. And if Pam Duncan-Glancy is amenable, should government amendments be supported, I am open to discussion on that point the member raised ahead of Stage 3. So, as such, I would ask members with amendments in this area to consider whether they still wish to push their amendments. Finally, I wish to address Amendments 123 and 183 concerning reporting duties in relation to victims and movement restriction conditions. Amendment 123 potentially creates significant demands relating to victims' experiences of the hearing system on a range of agencies. Some of this information is already published. SCRA publishes offence referral data annually, and that's broken down by offence type. However, the additional information stipulated in this amendment could lead to an incomplete and misleading representation of victims in the hearing system, and it's not clear to what end. How agencies collect and retain information in relation to victims varies according to their role and functions. Now, the SCRA Victim Information Service does a huge amount of work to identify victims through the referrals received from police. And for a wide range of reasons, a victim is not always identified in the information provided. The age profile of the victim is also not always identifiable from the information they have available. Any work in this area must be attentive to the considerations around sensitive data, how that's shared, what is published, and for what purpose. This would perhaps be more appropriately dealt with through qualitative research in conjunction with appropriate victim support organisations. Any information and support a victim receives must be given sensitively and in confidence, so detailed reporting on the information and support given to victims is likely to be incomplete, and it is not clear what value it adds. General information on the kind of things agencies can do for victims is otherwise available. Likewise, in relation to Amendment 183, as I mentioned earlier, there is already significant amounts of data broken into numerous categories, which is available through the online dashboard provided by the Scottish Children's Reporters Administration. And they also publish an annual in-depth detailed analysis of their statistics and details of MRCs. Will be available from next year onwards in their annual report. The amendment as framed framed extends further than the information that can be provided by SCRE, and it's difficult to know at this stage the extent to which usage of MRCs will change. If the numbers stay low, then the victim experience, for example, will not be capable of meaningful analysis. But I do think there's merit in further discussions about how to enhance the transparency of MRCs and other relevant measures for victims of cases referred to the children's hearing system in the future without the need for legislation. And if Willie Rennie is agreeable to this, I would ask him to withdraw his amendment on that basis for further discussion. So in summary, I move amendments 13, 15 and 17. I cannot support the other amendments in this group and ask members not to press them. If they are pressed, I would ask that the committee reject them.
Thank you, Minister. Willie Rennie, can I ask you to speak to Amendment 122 and other amendments in the group, please?
So I've got three amendments in this section, so apologies. I'm going to go into a little bit of detail. The purpose of Amendment 122 is to establish an information sharing system between the Children's Hearing System and the Single Point of Contact Service, or Elected Victim Support Organisation. It will be based on a robust risk assessment, the assessment of risk posed to the victim, person harmed, by the subject child. The degree of information provided to the victim will depend on the level of risk established by that risk assessment. The aim of the amendment is to successfully balance the subject child's right to privacy with the rights of the victim to information and support to recover, especially where they are a child. This will help to ensure that UNCRC rights are being fulfilled where possible for all children, not just the subject child. The right to privacy is important. However, it is not an absolute right and should not infringe other persons' right to safety or recovery. An objective and robust risk assessment is the best way to achieve a balance of these rights. I'm proposing a three-tiered system. The first tier is the information which all victims will be entitled to, whether their case is reported to the SCRA system and when it is processed through the children's hearing system. SCRA should operate this opt-out information system. All victims should be entitled to both information about how the system works and victim support resources, but also basic information on dates of hearings, the final decision of the hearing, and if the case has not been referred to a hearing. The second tier, so that's the basic level. The second tier would provide further case-specific information, particularly in relation to the compulsory supervision orders, where it is deemed that the child poses a significant risk of harm to themselves or others. It will include information on how a CSO works, dates, conditions, and what happens if the rules aren't stuck to. All this should enable a victim to plan for their own safety. This won't allow conditions under the CSO which relate to engagement with social work or personal details about the subject child to be shared. That wouldn't be appropriate. The third tier is of information sharing that will be reserved for cases where the panel has deemed the subject child must have their liberty restricted in secure accommodation due to the risk to the person who has been harmed or the wider public. This will be in cases where an offence has taken place. However, it is not restricted to referrals on offence grounds. Under the third tier, they will be notified when the child is released from secure accommodation or transferred to an adult prison. The information provided should replicate that which is provided through the victim notification system in the criminal justice system, where possible. Of course, victims can opt out. They can also choose to communicate through a trusted adult. Now, I'm pleased that the government has brought forward amendments 13, 15, 17 to share information with regards to CSOs, in particular with 13. But I can't understand why it's not brought forward an amendment like mine, which empowers the reporter to carry out a risk assessment for all child subjects and their victims. By restricting the scope, it potentially restricts the powers and discretion of the reporter to inform and share. I think it would be beneficial for all victims to have a basic understanding about how the system works and what they might expect. the dates of hearings that are included in Tier 1 don't include private or personal information. So I'd urge members to support Amendment 122, as it is a comprehensive covering, not just of CSOs, empowering the reporter. It's tiered depending on the severity, so it's sensitive and more sophisticated. Yes, certainly.
I thank Mr. Rennie for taking the intervention. I just wanted to be clear. I mean, I set out how far the government amendments go, and I have agreed that there is still scope that we could go further. I think it would be prudent, as I say, if the member still has areas of concern, like you've noted there, that we discuss these ahead of stage three, and that can, as I say, certainly be something that could be looked at ahead of stage three instead of pressing on with the amendments in their current form.
Okay. I would prefer more of a reassurance than a discussion, because I think we have got to... Yes, certainly.
I'm very grateful for William Rennie to give way on this. This is, of course, a public hearing where the evidence is... The contributions are noted and, in due course, could be reflected in decisions that are taken. So I think it is useful that people are able to articulate the position exactly as the Minister has done, but to also show where there is disagreement and whether or not that ground can be bridged before stage three, which is, of course, the last step in a bill before it potentially becomes legislation. So would Rennie agree that it is right that we are able to articulate the reasoning behind our amendments, which may actually reduce some of the discussion that needs to take place? Hopefully not that it doesn't need to take place, but that there's a positive reason for doing so.
Yes. Okay, so just a few more points. However, I'm not going to support Amendment 12 and 14 from Ros McCall, which removes the reporter's discretion around information sharing in a way that could harm children who had been referred to a hearing. I support Amendments 178, 175, 180 from Pam Duncan Glancy in relation to providing information to support safety planning and other information that may be relevant and proportionate to share with those who have been impacted by harmful behaviour. It's a broader set of amendments which would assist with information sharing. Okay, so turning to my amendment 123, which creates a reporting requirement to support an informed and constructive debate about how the wider redesign of the children's hearing system can ensure that all children have their rights fully respected and that no children are left behind. With the UNCRC Act soon to be in force, there is more reason than ever to take steps to make sure children's human rights are reflected in legislation that it passes, as well as ensuring the availability of the child suitable justice up to the age of 18. There is a clear need for a better support and connections to recovery and protection for children who have been harmed. To meet Article 19 on protection from abuse and Article 39 on access to recovery, support and safety planning should be available regardless of whether decisions have been taken to process further action through the children's hearing system or the criminal justice system or through no system at all. These two ambitions are not at odds with each other. It is possible to do better by both children whose actions may harm others and children who are harmed themselves. Making sure that this happens is critical to maintaining public support for the children's hearing system as a whole, which is a point clearly made in the Hearings for Children report. I'm concerned that there is too little understanding about how the experiences of children who are harmed, where this is then referred to the children's hearing system. With a more extensive redesign of the children's hearing system on the horizon, this does need to be addressed. I'm also concerned that once this bill is passed, the debate may be over, but we'll have only begun on the process of reform, which is why we need my amendment to create a reporting requirement to support that wider, constructive and comprehensive debate to consider all those involved with the system. Yes, certainly.
Thank you for taking the intervention. And I agree with him on the point of principle that these are not mutually exclusive outcomes that we're looking for here. And I'm conscious that Committee members have received lobbying and briefing from a range of organisations in the field of children's rights, victims' rights, etc. Some of which are asking us to support Willie Rennie's amendments, but in the Children's Commissioner's case are asking us to oppose amendments 122 and 123. I'm wondering if he agrees with me that we're not a million miles off a position acceptable to the government, other members on the committee and all key stakeholders here, and that there is scope to reach agreement on reporting arrangements ahead of stage three?
I think the government certainly has moved. I think the including the CSOs on sharing information in a much more specific fashion, I think is helpful. I think Amendment 17 is also helpful, although it is a bit vague and we could do with a bit more precision on exactly what the service is going to look like, but that might not be appropriate for legislation, but there is a bit of scepticism as to whether this will be forthcoming. So I accept that. What I don't understand is why an empowering, more comprehensive system where you empower the reporter to make that risk assessment across all children, making sure that there are no children who fall between the different stools, why that's not appropriate. It seems broader and empowering rather than more specific and narrow that the Minister has put in place, certainly.
Give way. One of the challenges in this legislation is within the legislation itself to make sure that this delicate balancing between the rights of the victim and the rights of the accused are balanced by requiring that as a necessity from a risk-based approach would go some way to doing that, although as you concede it might not be perfect. I think that's the point you're making, that it becomes intrinsic to the bill. Am I correct in that?
Yeah, that's right. And we want to make sure, we don't want to alter the fundamental approach of the children's hearing system. We accept that it's been built up over many years. But there is a feeling that, especially when you're moving a group that were previously in the criminal justice system into the under 18 children's hearing system, that the rights that were there before won't be continued. And therefore, having it intrinsically built into the children's hearing system, that a broad-based risk assessment is made, empowering the professionals who are making that judgment, is the best way to proceed. So I think it's not unreasonable, it's not restrictive, and therefore I think it would meet Michelle Thompson's point. Is there any other, before I move on to the next? Okay, carry on. Yeah. So I support 218 and 219 with Martin Whitfield, and Amendment 17 would also be appropriate. I support Amendment 173 from Pam Duncan Glancy in relation to CSOs, considering the impact on a person affected by offending behaviour, as this should allow a proportionate consideration of the full facts behind a referral, while still maintaining the needs, not deeds, ethos. Ros McCall's 4 and 5 I support, as to include more places in the restriction conditions is sensible, but 6 is a promise that couldn't realistically be met in all circumstances. We need to be straight with people about the limitations of what is possible to absolutely prevent. So finally, almost there, Amendment 183 does something similar to 182 in the previous debate, and I'm conscious of what the Minister said about having further discussions in this area. I would like to make sure that a system somehow, whether it's through this bill or otherwise, does include more details so we can analyse the effectiveness or otherwise of movement restriction orders. But I'm not going to press that amendment when it comes to the vote, considering the Minister's reassurance on that front. And that's me.
That's you, Mr Rennie. OK, thank you. Looking to see if any other members want to come in. OK, Ros McCall, to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 2, please.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah, thank you very much, convener. I'm not going to speak long on this. I accept the government's offer to speak, especially on amendments 4 and 5. So I'm not going to move forward with the amendments in this group. And hopefully we can move forward with some changing in wording and press the point for stage 3. Thank you, convener.
Can I ask the member what her intention is with Amendment 2.
Sorry, I'm not pressing all or so to withdraw it, sorry, for 2.
Okay, so can I... Ros McCall seeks to withdraw Amendment 2. Does any member object? No. Okay, thank you. Can I then call Amendment 167 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 165. Martin Whitfield to move or not move?
Not move.
Does any member object? The question... I call Amendment 166 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 165. Martin Whitfield to move or not move?
Not move.
So the member seeks to withdraw Amendment 165. So does any member object? Not moved. Sorry. I'm told I don't have to check if there's objections later in the group. Okay, so not moved. Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. And so now the next question is that Amendment 166 be The Amendment 168 in the name of Pam Duncan Clancy, already debated with Amendment 2. Pam Duncan Clancy to move or not move?
Move.
Okay. Let's move. There will be a division. Oh, we don't know. Ask first. The question is that Amendment 168 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Okay, so we are not agreed, so there will be a division. If we hold on. Are you ready?
Yep.
Okay, so those in favour of 168, please. Those against 168. Is that them all? No abstentions? You had your hand up previously, didn't you? We're just checking. Yeah. So the result on Amendment 168 is 4-4, and against 6, with no abstention. So the amendment is not agreed. We're now moving to ways of working and training, and I call Amendment 169 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy, group with amendments 187, 188, 210 and 211. Pam Duncan Glancy to move Amendment 169 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Oh, thank you, Convener. Thank you, Presiding Convener. Thank you, Convener. Forgive me, colleagues. My amendments in this group seek to ensure that we foster a system that is able to understand and support the unique needs and vulnerabilities of young people. My amendments 210 and 187 require training for criminal justice agencies and the Children's Panel itself, respectively, on child development, children's rights and domestic abuse. Training to promote a better understanding of child development will equip professionals to interact with children in a manner that recognises their age and circumstances and specific needs, a cornerstone, I believe, of providing appropriate and sensitive care. Training on the UNCRC ensures professionals in the system are better positioned to uphold the principles of fairness, equality and respect throughout legal proceedings, which will equip and empower them to create an environment where children's voices are heard and their rights are prioritised. In the context of domestic abuse, specialised training ensures that professionals can identify the signs of trauma, address the immediate safety concerns, and adopt a child-centric approach that prioritises the well-being of the young person involved and seeks to avoid or minimise the risk of exposing them to the recurrence of past trauma or further trauma. Amendment 169, in my name, dictates that children's hearings must carry out their functions in a way that accords with trauma-informed practice. The Scottish Government have themselves recognised the importance of trauma-informed practice to improving the experiences of victims and witnesses. The standards of service to which criminal justice agencies are held to include, of course, a commitment to trauma-informed practice. Many of the children who come into contact with the children's hearing system, regardless of the grounds upon which they're referred, will have had adverse childhood experiences. As such, ensuring that the system carries out its functions in a way that accords with trauma-informed practice, I believe, will be beneficial to all those engaging with the system, including those who have affected a child's offending behaviour, who have been affected by a child's behaviour. Beyond training, I think a multi-agency approach to supporting children involved in criminal proceedings is also vital to comprehensively addressing the diverse needs of children within the system. A multi-agency approach allows for a holistic understanding of the child's circumstance, recognising that their wellbeing is linked to various areas of their life, and enables tailored interventions that go beyond legal proceedings by facilitating coordination and communication among different agencies, which I believe will ultimately contribute to the development and rehabilitation of the child. My Amendment 211 recommends that the Government promote such approach, and I also support Martin Whitfield's Amendment 188, which calls for reporting each year on the steps it's taking to do so. I urge colleagues to support my amendments on the basis that I have set out, and in doing so, recognise the value of a multi-agency approach and the importance of training for criminal justice agencies and panels, which cannot be overstated, particularly when it comes to child development. A well-trained workforce is fundamental to creating a justice system that is responsive, empathetic and capable of safeguarding both the rights of the child and wellbeing and the rights of victims and legal protections in all processes. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Clancy. Can I now ask Martin Whitfield to speak to Amendment 188 and other amendments in the group, please?
I'm very grateful, Convener. And I am, as always, conscious of time and the contribution necessary to get these over the line. This is really the reporting duty to hold to account the use of multi-agency approaches, because there is no one solution that's going to help any individual young person, and it's the coming together of the different areas of support. And there is an obligation on Scottish ministers to make sure that those different areas of support can come together, are recognised and have a say in supporting our young people. And the purpose of 188 is to provide a requirement to set out the steps that have been taken, the steps and approaches that have been pursued, so that we can hold to account the Scottish ministers as those responsible, or the Scottish Government, to hold responsible for this approach. Great.
Field. Can I now ask the Minister to respond? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Again, I'd like to say at the outset that I do appreciate the intentions behind Mr Whitfield and Ms Duncan Glancy's amendments here. Now, on the training of panel members in Amendment 187, this is clearly a very important area. Measures are currently in place by the National Convener to ensure necessary and proportionate training. However, it's not clear why the particular subjects in this amendment would need to be legislated for above others in this way. Children's Hearing Scotland are a listed public authority under Section 15 of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child Act, and this means they are not only required to comply with the UNCRC, but will also be required to report on action they have taken or intend to take to ensure compliance and secure better or further effect of the rights of children. Children's rights training for panel members is already offered and will form an integral part of this reporting requirement. So this aspect appears to already be appropriately covered by other legislation. Establishing a good understanding of child development forms part of existing training for panel members and can be a key consideration in how a child effectively participates in their hearing. However, as Children's Hearing Scotland guidance currently issued to panel member states, panel members are not and should not attempt to be seen as child development specialists. Similarly, all panel members receive training on domestic abuse as part of their wider training on trauma. Panel members must know how to approach cases where domestic abuse is one of the grounds of referral, but also where domestic abuse is intertwined with other issues which need to be addressed by a hearing. However, domestic abuse is one of many child welfare concerns which may come before a panel and will not be a relevant consideration in all cases. I'm therefore not clear on the reasons why domestic abuse and child development, would those specific issues, would need to be specifically elevated in status under Schedule 2 to the 2011 Act. I'm comfortable that they already form a proportionate part of the comprehensive training already offered to panel members, and that children's rights training is appropriately covered in other legislative requirements. So on that basis, I would not support Amendment 187.
On those points?
Yes.
Thank you. So to clarify, the purposes of setting them out in this of legislation is because of the nature of what the intention of and the purpose of the general bill is. It's also domestic abuse, for example, is in there because it recognises the evidence that the committee heard from various organisations, including Police Scotland, around the likelihood of more domestic abuse cases potentially coming to the panel and in the children's hearing system. And so on that basis, I don't see any negative reason not to include it as a compulsory and legislative measure. We know that, for example, training that is currently given to panel members is of a high standard, but not all of it is mandatory, and there's nothing that specifically sets in legislation what that training should be. And I think that given the changes this bill proposes, it's particularly important to set this in legislation at this time.
I thank the member for that intervention. However, as I've already said, I feel like these are already covered under in other areas. I am conscious about duplication. I absolutely agree that these are very important areas, but as I've said, panel members are already trained in these areas, and I'm actually about to come on to trauma training, and it's something that we could maybe look at as a whole to this. But in terms of this specific amendment, I do not agree that it is necessary. So similarly on Amendment 210, whilst I agree with the thrust of the member's intention that appropriate training should be in place in the context of children's criminal justice, the amendment is not necessarily clear in terms of who the proposed training is to apply to and what the training should entail. We don't have any evidence to suggest that the kind of training detailed in this amendment is not currently available, and the Scottish Government funds a range of agencies which provide training that can be accessed by staff working with children involved in the youth and criminal justice systems. Further, we do not consider it constitutionally appropriate that the Scottish ministers should arrange training for those who must act independently from government, such as the police, prosecutors and judges. It's important, I think, that we don't stray into inappropriate interference in investigatory, prosecutorial and judicial functions, and respect the ability of criminal justice authorities to determine the most appropriate training for their staff in function of their role. I therefore, again, I could not support Amendment 210. Now, on Amendment 169, while I appreciate the intention here, I don't, again, believe it is necessary. Children's hearings are in many ways ahead of the curve in terms of trauma-informed practice, and all panel members receive mandatory trauma-informed training through a standalone training module provided by CHS. Trauma-informed practice also forms part of the pre-service training for panel members, so no panel member sits on a children's hearing without being trained in trauma-informed practice. Beyond panel members, children's reporters also receive training in trauma-informed practice to ensure all the preparatory work is undertaken in a trauma-informed way. Again, as part of our response to the Hearings for Children's report, we've committed to national oversight of the resourcing and provision of trauma training for all working within the hearing system. Now, this will be wider in scope than the conduct of children's hearings and will include the judiciary and local authorities. We'll work with key stakeholders to ensure these aspirations are met and the existing resources are fully utilised. If this work establishes the need for legislative provisions to embed trauma-informed practice across the hearing system, this would be most appropriately taken forward as part of any legislation flowing from the redesign work. Now, while 169 appears not to be needed, because as I've just iterated, it already happens in practice, and we are working to go wider and further as part of our work to redesign the hearing system, if Ms Duncan Glancy is willing to not press it, I'm more than happy again to work with her ahead of Stage 3 to see if something such as a handout amendment would be desirable. On Amendments 188 and 211, I recognise, understand and value the importance of providing all children and young people, including those who are referred to a children's hearing or involved in criminal proceedings, with the right support at the right time and from the right people. The Scottish Government has concerns that creating a legal duty on promoting a multi-agency approach to planning support and the reporting requirements which would accompany that duty would undermine the existing and embedded shared responsibility for implementing the Getting It Right for Every Child or GIRFEC approach. It would also create duplication within existing statutory reporting requirements for local authorities and Scottish ministers related to children's services planning. GRFEC promotes an integrated and coordinated approach to multi-agency assessment and planning support for children and young people. It's locally embedded and positively embraced by organisations, services and practitioners across children's services planning partnerships, with a focus on changing culture, systems and practice to improve outcomes for babies, infants, children, young people and their families. There are existing statutory measures in place to ensure that local authorities produce annual children's services plans under criteria outlined in Part 3 of the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, which includes provisions around incorporating a multi-agency practice approach. Scottish ministers also have a statutory requirement to publish a review of such plans every 3 years.
Point.
Yes.
I thank the Minister for taking that intervention. And the Minister will be aware that those plans are of an aggregate nature, so they cover all young people in a particular local authority on a more general basis. The amendments in Martin Whitfield and I's name specifically locate the multi-agency approach within the very specific child that is there at the time. So the plans that the Minister has mentioned aren't plans that are available for individual children, but are plans that organisations put in place to say that they will have referral agencies available to them. This makes it much more specific to the child and makes sure that those agencies and the duties that they should dispose are done so in a way that's very relevant to the individual child and not on a wider basis.
I thank the member for that intervention. I have numerous other points in relation to these amendments. There are existing statutory measures in place. In Scotland, we have promoted a multi-agency partnership whole system approach to preventing offending by children since 2011, responding to the needs of children involved in or on the cusp of being in conflict with the law, and creating an additional legal duty within the bill for Scottish ministers to promote a multi-agency approach and, crucially, to produce a report to outline what support has been provided would risk undermining that shared responsibility of implementing the GRFEC multi-agency approach at all levels of the system. We've committed, as part of our response to the hearings system redesign report, to undertake a national review of potentially multiple child protection, care and support processes and meetings, including review meetings. And this will help identify where unnecessary duplication takes place and to minimise that for the benefit of children and families. Preparatory work is already underway for that review, and I'm looking forward to progressing this with input from the Children's Hearings Redesign Board and other key partners in early 2024. So again, in summary, the Government does not support Amendments 169, 187, 188, 210, 211, and I urge members not to press them. If they are pressed, I would urge the committee to reject them. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Clancy, to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 169, please.
Before I do that, Convener, could I ask a question of the Minister about the commitment made to discuss Amendment 169? Is that permitted?
Yes, it is.
Thank you. Much appreciated, Convener. Minister, you indicated that you'd be willing to discuss Amendment 169 and look at what we can put in place. Could you give me a bit more information about the sorts of parameters in which that discussion would take place so that I've got an understanding of how much the Government are prepared to move on it?
Well, I'm probably not going to be able to go into specifics about every single amendment that I'm saying this on today, but what I would say is that I had extensive engagement with the committee members between stage one and stage two, and a lot of what committee members raised with me has been formulated in terms of government amendments that we are lodging. So I hope that that emphasises both my willingness to work with members and my willingness to listen to them as well. Because as I've said before, my priority is that we get this right for Scotland's children and young people. So while I can't tell the member exactly what will be detailed in those discussions, I am willing to have those discussions and I'm willing to have as many of them until we get to a point where I think that is workable.
Okay, I thank the Minister for that response. I'm not sure that it gives me much reassurance about Amendment 169. I take the point that the Minister said that she's willing to discuss. On the basis that I'm an optimist and I'm willing to consider what the Minister has said on the record, But also that I hope that that means we will get an amendment at stage three that looks at including trauma-informed practice, as my amendment 169 suggests. I'm prepared to hold my position on that. I'm happy to give way to the Minister.
Thank Ms Duncan-Glancy. I mean, I did mention that a handout amendment or something similar would be possible. Again, I can't go into specific details on that today because I need to see where we get to at the end of stage two. But as I said, my commitment to work with the member is on record.
Thank you, Minister. I appreciate that. And I appreciate the context of a handout amendment. It was more the content of that handout that I was seeking to get further assurance on. But on that basis, I am prepared not to press 169 when asked. I am considering still pressing the other amendments in my name in this group. Is this the appropriate time not to press, but to talk to that?
I specifically asked for you to wind up, press or withdraw amendment 169.
You're quite right, Convener, that's exactly what you did, forgive me. I will not press amendment 169 at this time in the hope of making changes at stage three instead.
So Pam Duncan-Glancy seeks to withdraw amendment 169. Does any member object? No. Okay. I call amendment 170 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with amendment 165. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call amendment 171 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with amendment 165. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call amendment 119 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with amendment 165. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Thank you, Convener. I listened to what the Minister said, and given the Government's current consultation with regards to Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill, I hope across government, and I note recently actually there's been a letter from many organisations to all ministers with regards to improvements. So I hope, although the Minister didn't mention this, this is something potentially for future bills we need to see taken forward. So I won't be moving 119.
And now I call Amendment 120 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 165. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Wise, not moved.
Thank you. I call Amendment 121 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 165. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. And with that, I'm actually going to suspend the meeting for 15 minutes for a short break. Thank you very much. Okay. Okay, that's us back. Welcome back. We now move to the section Emergency Placement in Secure Accommodation, and I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister in a group on its own. Minister, to move and speak to Amendment 1, please.
Thank you, Convener. The Children's Hearing Scotland Act contains a range of existing child assessment and child protection measures to enable the placement and keeping of a child in place of safety where necessary to protect a child from serious harm risks. It has always been possible for a child to be taken or removed to and kept in secure accommodation by virtue of these emergency measures. However, in practice, the use of secure accommodation for this purpose has been rare, and at times the ability to do so contested between agencies. A small number of local authorities have raised this with the Scottish Government. On further consideration, the Government considers that there should be more explicit reference to the secure accommodation criteria and appropriate procedural safeguards should such measures be used to take and remove or keep a child in secure accommodation. Therefore, the amendments firstly promote legal certainty about when such measures can be used for the purposes of taking, placing and keeping a child in secure. Secondly, they promote consistency with the considerations needed for other routes to secure accommodation. For example, a compulsory supervision order by a children's hearing containing a secure accommodation authorisation. And thirdly, ensure that any placement is subject to appropriate legal safeguards to uphold the rights of the child where a child is being deprived of their liberty by virtue of any placement in secure accommodation. The new Section 57A of the 2011 Act makes clear that in these situations, as well as a child requiring to meet the criteria for a particular child assessment or protection measure, the child can only be taken to, placed and kept in secure accommodation subject to two important safeguards. Firstly, this should only be where the child meets the secure accommodation criteria set out in subsection 4 of that provision, which reflects the criteria for secure accommodation authorisations as amended by section 5 of the Bill. Secondly, the relevant decision maker must, having considered the other options available, be satisfied that it is necessary for the child to be taken or removed to or kept in secure accommodation. The new Section 57B of the 2011 Act will enable further provision to be made in regulations subject to affirmative procedure in respect of children placed in secure accommodation by virtue of these provisions. So that could, for example, enable provision to be made to ensure that any placement in such accommodation would require the consent or agreement of the head of the unit of accommodation or, as the case may be, a chief social worker of the relevant local authority, as well as provision to protect the welfare of a child who is placed and kept in such accommodation. This will ensure consistency with the regulation of other placements in secure accommodation. I therefore move this amendment and I would ask other members to support it.
Do any other members wish to contribute? Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful. It's really just a point of clarification. Has the Minister considered a situation where there might be a disagreement between, in essence, the provider and the senior social worker, and whether it would be the senior social worker's decision that would prevail in that case?
Yes, absolutely. And obviously that was something that was picked up on as I referenced. And I think that's something that we absolutely need to monitor going forward.
I'm grateful. Grateful, Convener.
Okay. Minister, to wind up or
move the amendment. Okay.
So, the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. The Amendment 1 is agreed. Prosecution of children and appropriate system. I call Amendment 3 in the name of Ros McCall, group with Amendments 18, 19, 189 and 190. Ros McCall to move Amendment 3 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Convener. Prosecution of children appropriate system. This only applies to cases that would be considered as the most serious of offences. I know you've gone over this, but I'm going to repeat them. The offences covered are those required by law to be prosecuted on indictment. which are common law offences of murder, treason, rape, certain statutory offences, including possession of a firearm with intent to injure, causing death by dangerous driving, sexual assault by penetration, rape of a young child, sexual assault on a young child by penetration. The intent of these is to ensure that such cases are prosecuted via criminal courts and cannot be dealt with by the children's reporter. Now, it's so important that the Mackey Review is enacted in tandem with this bill, and I note that the government's response to the Mackey Review was posted just before Christmas recess. And the changes to the Children Hearing Panel, funding for paid positions and training are all crucial parts for ensuring the bill works for all young people. And as the government are not going to support the recommendation for paid positions, I will continue, and will continue to follow the existing volunteer model, which is unfortunately hemorrhaging volunteers, it's essential that most serious offences for 16 and 17 proceed through criminal courts. So the Amendment 3 seeks to prevent the principal reporter from being able to investigate and refer cases to a children's hearing where the child is accused of serious offences, as already stated. And this will include children aged 16 or over, and 18 and 19 would require the Lord Advocate in cases to require to consider the risk to the victim and the child is dealt with via the children's hearing system instead of being prosecuted. Yes, I will.
Thank Ros McCall for taking an intervention. It could be said that these amendments are at complete odds with the principle of the bill and in keeping the promise. How would the member respond to that?
Sorry, I have to take my glasses off and on for this. The promise. There are. I'm trying to articulate. There are certain criminal offences that will be have to be treated as severe. They are solemn court cases. They should be going through a process that is recognizance of that solemn process. It is therefore important that we have an option to be able to do that, especially when it comes to serious crime. The situation is that we have not only children who are cause harm that we have to be mindful of, but there are people who we have to be mindful of who have had harm inflicted upon them. And these amendments are there to ensure that in the one or two cases where it's required, then there is that option to go through the criminal process, especially when it comes to these severe criminal processes. I have spoken to the two amendments, the three amendments, and I'll be done.
I wasn't sure if you wanted to respond further. That's fine.
Thank you.
Can I now call on Liam Kerr to speak to Amendment 189 and other amendments in the group, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning to all. With the committee's indulgence, I'll speak today on behalf of my colleague Russell Findlay, who's lodged several amendments. He's asked me to apologise for his non-attendance, which is because he sits on the Criminal Justice Committee, which is currently taking evidence from witnesses about other legislation. Transparency is critical to the functioning of Scotland's justice system. In recent years, more cases of a criminal nature have been directed to the children's panel system rather than being prosecuted in the criminal courts. And this is likely to become more common. Some of these cases already, as we've heard, involve serious crimes of violence and sexual violence. In addition, this bill is proposing that the age limit for children's panel referrals will increase from 16 to 18, which will also generate more panel cases, some of which will be criminal in nature. Now, on March the 29th, the Criminal Justice Committee took evidence on this legislation. Russell Findlay asked Kate Wallace of Victim Support Scotland about a lack of transparency for victims in relation to the panel system. And she said, and I'm quoting, "One of the biggest issues that comes to us for people in that situation is that they're really surprised by the lack of information. A lot of effort is put into explaining the process to them, but they do not get any information about their own circumstances. Therefore, it is difficult for people not only to understand what is happening to the perpetrator, but to safely plan for their own recovery. That becomes really challenging when you operate in a total information vacuum." Now, she went on to say, "Information sharing provisions are needed so that people are clear about what information can and will be shared with people who have been harmed by a child or young person. The types of information that will be shared need to be spelled out If you go through an adult system, you have rights to information about updates to do with your case. For example, she says, if someone escapes or absconds from a prison setting, you are entitled to that information. If you sign up to the victim notification scheme, you are also entitled to know when that person has been released. None of those provisions apply when a child or young person has harmed you. That aspect of the bill needs to be considered, and provisions need to be put in place on it. Now, Russell Finlay agrees with Victim Support Scotland, as do I. And this amendment, which I hereby move, helps to fill that information vacuum experienced by crime victims. Moving on, Amendment 190, in the name of Russell Finlay, is also one relating to transparency. For victims or bereaved relatives, the justice system can often be unfamiliar and, I dare say, traumatic. Now, the Crown say, quote, providing reasons for decisions is essential to retain confidence and to deliver accountability and transparency to those whose lives have been affected. Now, in 2015, the Victims' Right to Review scheme was introduced by the Crown Office. That gives victims the right to request a review of the decision by the Crown Office not to prosecute a criminal case or to discontinue criminal proceedings that have commenced. And that's why this amendment is necessary, because it seeks to extend those same important rights to those victims where the alleged perpetrator is not prosecuted but instead sent to the Children's Panel. Members might find some context useful here. A 2018 thematic review of this scheme that I've spoken of was published by the Inspectorate of Prosecution in Scotland. It found that over a particular one-year period, the Crown received one review request for every 306 cases where a decision was taken not to prosecute or to discontinue proceedings. Now, interestingly, around 10% of these applicants were successful. And I think it seems likely that we might see similar rates of appeals taking place for the smaller number of cases involving young people. And that's why this needs to be in the bill. Victims can't rely on ministerial assurances that it will happen. And that is why I therefore move amendments 189 and 190 in Russell Finlay's name.
Thank you. Looking for any other members wishing to go? Russ Greer.
Commissioner, and apologies, I probably should have intervened and posed this as a question to Ros McCall, so if you could maybe address this and sum it up, I'd be grateful. To some extent, it applies to 189 and 190 as well, but I'm more interested in 18 and 19. The Scotland Act enshrines, and it's quite an important principle, the prosecutorial independence of the Lord Advocate, but 18 and 19 here seem to undermine or erode that, or at least to narrow it. I'd be keen if Ros McCall was able to expand a little bit on that point, because to me it raises issues of competence in relation to the Scotland Act, but also the principle of the Lord Advocate's independence, which has been a growing debate in Parliament over the last couple of years.
Thank you, Mr. Greer. Okay. No, any other members? Can I now ask the Minister to respond? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, as we understand it, Amendment 3 seeks to prohibit the principal reporter from referring a child aged 16 or over to the children's hearing where it's alleged that a child has committed an offence that can only be tried on indictment. Moreover, Amendment 19 seeks to compel the Lord Advocate to instruct the prosecution of such a child in relation to such an offence rather than referring the child to a children's hearing. Amendment 18 also seeks to compel the Lord Advocate to prosecute any child in respect of an alleged offence where there is a high risk of physical or psychological harm to the alleged victim of that offence if prosecution is not pursued, rather than referring the child to a children's hearing. It's not clear what level of risk is high in this context, or how prosecuting the child rather than dealing with the child through the children's hearing system would have an impact on that. In any case, the risk of harm if the Lord Advocate chooses prosecution at this stage can be dealt with through consideration of whether the accused is granted bail or remanded in custody, as was made clear recently in the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Act, which put public safety, including in particular the safety of victims, at the heart of decisions on bail and remand. Taken together, these amendments aim to restrict the ability of all children under 18 to have their cases dealt with by the children's hearing system where this is appropriate. This is a fundamental principle of this bill, as endorsed by Parliament at stage one. And it's interesting that this is proposed by the Conservatives only a week after the UNCRC incorporation bill received royal assent following cross-party support. I'm actually surprised at this turnaround on children's rights, and as such, this amendment goes against the general direction and the principles of this bill. Amendment 189 compels the Lord Advocate to inform any person who appears to be a victim where a child is referred to the principal reporter under the decision-making process governing joint referral for offences instead of being prosecuted. However, it's not clear how such a victim is to be determined, given that there has not been any determination of the case, whether by the children's hearings or a court. So there's significant ambiguity there in the drafting. Amendment 190 allows any person who is or appears... Yes, I'll take an intervention from Mr Kerr.
Do I take it from that then that the Minister is opposing Amendment 189 on the grounds that she feels it's ambiguous, or that she is minded to support it but simply seeks more clarity?
I am opposing it for clarity.
On the ground of it being ambiguous?
Yes, and other grounds, as I've just laid out for the member. Amendment 190 allows any person who is or appears...
It's a point of clarity for me. I accept what the Minister's saying about the ambiguity in the context of the amendment itself, but the principle of victims' rights to be kept informed, particularly where it's a very traumatic thing, which happens in other areas... Has the Minister had further thinking, and therefore is she alluding that further consideration will be given to this principle for stage three, or are they discounting the principle altogether?
I'm discounting this amendment the way it is worded altogether. I've already been very clear in terms of victims' rights and information to victims. The government, I've already went through the government's amendments in relation to more information to victims, and actually I intend to cover that at the end of my speaking note as well. So if the convener would be happy for me to continue, and then I'm happy to come in any other questions at the end. So, Amendment 190 allows any person who is or appears to be a victim to seek a review where a child is referred to the principal reporter under the decision-making process governing joint referral. Now, as well as going against the grain of the bill, this also flies in the face of existing law and practice. So, for example, whilst Amendment 3 provides that the principal reporter should refer the matter of alleged serious offending by a child to the Lord Advocate, this is unnecessary. Current law and guidance mean that both will receive a report of the alleged offending behaviour from the police. The Lord Advocate will carefully consider the case for prosecuting the child in light of this, taking into account all factors relevant to the public interest, including the rights of any potential victim. Yes, I will take an intervention from Mr Kerr.
So on that point, the Minister believes that it is not open to people to request a review as it would be in the other courts. Is that the principle that she's founding upon?
I don't think that that is a decision for me as a minister to take, and that's what I'm trying to lay out here.
Well, with respect, you are opposing the amendment, Minister, and therefore I'm asking you to articulate your precise reasons for doing so.
And that's exactly what I have just done. I've articulated my reasons for opposing the amendment. I really don't see how I could be any clearer than that.
The Minister will proceed, and if there's any further questions, we can take them at the end in terms of points of clarity on this matter.
So, essentially, fundamentally, at the bottom, at the root of this, the amendments in this group from the Conservatives interfere with the constitutional independence of the Lord Advocate in relation to prosecutorial decision-making, and as a Parliament, as a Minister, I cannot undermine that. Members will be aware that following the committee's Stage 1 report, where a recommendation was made concerning the Lord Advocate's prosecution guidelines, she wrote to the committee stating, "It is a fundamental principle of Scots constitutional law that as the independent head of the systems of criminal prosecution and investigation of deaths in Scotland, the Lord Advocate takes decisions independently of any other person." The same principle is being breached by these amendments, and should the committee be minded to agree them, it would seem very likely that similar representation will be made, an action needed by Parliament at stage three.
Yes.
But the principal is not offended by amendments 189 and 190. That is factually incorrect. Is it not?
I don't believe it is, no. I think we're at loggerheads in terms of agreement here.
They're not going to. Doesn't appear there's going to be agreement with the two with positions. Can I ask the minister to carry on?
Of course. Before I come to a close, Mr. Kerr raised issues around victim support earlier on in his contribution, and as I said earlier, I've already spoke to the changes that we are making, that the government are proposing in relation to this, and I've also offered to work with members on further changes to this. I really don't think that trying to compel the Lord Advocate or limit 16 and 17-year-olds from being able to have their liberty deprived in a secure care rather than a young offenders institution is the best way to proceed with this. And as I've already said, that goes against the general principles of the bill. So, convener, the government cannot support amendments 3, 18, 19, 189 and 190. I would urge Ms McCall and Mr Findlay not to press them. If they are pressed, I urge the committee to reject them. Mr Kerr.
Ros McCall now to wind up, press or withdraw amendment 3, please.
Thank you, convener. If I could just try and respond to Mr Greer's comments. I would say that the amendment was only trying to refer references cases to Lord Advocate rather than impacting on her decision. But with regard to amendment three, we're going to withdraw.
Okay. Ros McCall seeks to withdraw amendment three. Does any member object? Okay. I call amendment 172 in the name Pam Duncan Glancy, already debated with amendment 165. Pam Duncan Clancy to move or not move?
Move this amendment, please.
Move. Okay. The question is that amendment 172 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Just wait till we're ready. Okay. Those in favour of amendment 172... All right. You got them? Those against, please. Thank you. Okay. The result of the vote on Amendment 172 is 4-4. Against 6, with no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is that section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, thank you. I call amendment 4 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with amendment 2. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 5 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated. The clerks are trying to keep up with me. I call Amendment 5 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 2. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
Okay. The question is that Section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 173 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy, already debated with Amendment 2. Pam Duncan Glancy to move or not move? Move. The question is that Amendment 173 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Okay, hold on. You ready? Those in favour of Amendment 173. Okay, you got.
Yep.
Those against. Thank you. So the result in respect of Amendment 173 is 4-4 against 6. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 6 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 2. Ros McCall, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Hold on 2 seconds. This is just me pausing. There's nothing in my head over there. In terms of time, that's fine. There's good terminology. There's nothing in my head. So we're moving on to terminology, and I'm going to call Amendment 7 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 8, 9, 10 and 114. Minister, to move Amendment 7 and speak to all amendments in the group. Please.
Thank you, Convener. The use of language in proceedings concerning children has been highlighted as an area that is due for modernisation, and that is why the Government has proposed the amendments within this group. They don't necessarily seek to change the fundamental nature of the test they apply to, but to more accurately reflect what considerations should be taken into account in respect of a child's welfare. The new terminology of health, safety and development will be more readily understood by children and young people within the hearing system, and rather than the previous language, for example, around the risk to moral welfare, which is outdated and harks back to a different time. Now, Amendment 7 seeks to update the language of risks to welfare, including moral welfare, to that of risks to a child's health, safety and development when referring to the test concerning whether a compulsory supervision order should include a movement restriction condition. Amendment 8 proposes to make a similar change, but in respect of a compulsory supervision order containing a secure accommodation authorisation. Amendment 9 does likewise in relation to medical examination orders by children's hearing in respect of a child. Amendment 10 will achieve a similar outcome in reference to the test for a warrant to secure attendance in respect of a child. And finally, for consistency, Amendment 114 amends other provisions of the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011 concerning whether or not a child should be excused from attending a children's hearing or a court hearing to consider grounds of referral. I move Amendment 7 and I ask the committee to support the other amendments in this group.
Any member seek to comment? Okay. Minister, to wind up, please.
I've nothing further to say, Convener, and I move the amendments.
Okay. The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay. The amendment is agreed. I call Amendment 174 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 2. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. So the question is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I'm sorry, I'm looking to Liam Kerr.
Forgive me, Convener. Do you not need to ask the committee if it accepts the withdrawal?
Not on this one, no. Okay. Only if it's the first amendment in the grouping. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. So the question to the committee is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, thank you. I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 7. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Okay. The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I call Amendment 176 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 2. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. Call Amendment 9 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 7. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay. I call Amendment 10 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 7. Minister?
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. No, my next question is that Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I now call Amendment 177 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 165. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Not move.
So we now move on to the Young Offenders Institutions for Over 16s, and I call Amendment 11 in the name of Ros McCall, group with amendments as shown in the grouping. Ros McCall, to move Amendment 11 and speak to all the amendments in the group, please.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Young Offenders Institutions for Over 16s. Now, I understand the trepidation of these amendments, but I felt it was important to pinpoint the position, and I want to state that these are probing amendments, and I will not be moving them, but I reserve the right to bring back, because I think there's some important points that the Bill might not necessarily take into consideration, and hopefully this narrative will help explain the reason behind them. For 16 and 17-year-olds are considered the most serious offences, and I've already stated what they are. They'll be placed into a position where they are resigned with a CSO with a residential placement or movement restriction conditions. A CSO in a residential care facility means that the potential for care-experienced young people who have caused harm will be located beside care-experienced young people who are protected from harm. Understanding the effects of trauma in this case means instant anxiety, fear and perceived danger for the care-experienced young person we are there to protect from harm. And no amount of separation within one facility will mitigate, and re-traumatisation is inevitable. So it is essential that there is adequate government funding to ensure that there are sufficient residential facilities to ensure the scenario laid out is not an option. So I'm bringing these forward because the balance, I'm concerned, is not there. I will not be, as I've already stated, moving these amendments, but I need reassurances from the government, and I'm interested in what the government's response will be to this, to ensure that we do not have a situation where young people that we are charged to take care of, because they are unsafe in their home environment, are placed with people we are charged to take care of because they have caused harm. So I will not be moving these amendments, but I raise the point, and I'm very interested in the Scottish Government's response. Thank you.
I'm looking for other members before I ask. Okay, Minister. Frantically scribbling.
Thank you, Convener. Prisons are not places for children, and we are committed to keeping them out of prison through provisions in the Bill which end the placement of under-18s in young offenders institutions. These amendments run contrary to that by retaining the use of young offenders institutions for children aged 16 and 17, and indeed extend that position to all those aged 16 to 18. They would also go against our commitment to keep the promise, which stated, Scotland must recognise that 16 and 17-year-olds are children in line with the UNCRC and must be accommodated within secure care rather than within young offenders institutions and the prison estate. This must include children who are on remand and those who have been sentenced. YOIs are not appropriate places for children and only serve to perpetuate the pain that many of them have experienced. And the incorporation of the UNCRC reinforces that position. Now, I appreciate Ms McCall is not going to move these amendments. However, I really do think it would have been more productive to come to me with the concerns that you have around provision of secure care and those other areas, so that we could have discussed those ahead of stage two. But as I say, I'm willing to have those discussions going forward as well. There have been cross-party support in this Parliament for both keeping the promise and incorporation of the UNCRC. Support for a progressive approach to children's rights was evidenced by many of the consultation responses on this bill and during stage one evidence. This was echoed in the committee's stage one report, which supported the ending of YOIs for under-18s. Now, there is a view shared by stakeholders, including HM Chief Inspector of Prisons for Scotland, Children and Young People's Centre for Justice and the Office of Children and Young People's Commissioner for Scotland, regarding the need for urgency in bringing about the legislative changes necessary to end imprisonment of children in Scotland. Now, in terms of the detail of the amendments, Amendment 11 would add to the powers of a children's hearing on reviewing an order under Section 138 of the Children's Hearing Scotland Act to enable certain children to be moved from secure to a YOI. This amendment conflates aspects of the children's hearing system and the criminal justice system by providing that some children could be referred by a children's hearing for a detention in a YOI. As we've already discussed this morning, the children's hearing system is a welfare-based tribunal rather than a court, and a children's hearing cannot determine that a child should be placed in a YOI. This could only be a decision for a court. In addition, a child referred to a hearing on offence grounds and placed in secure may do so without offence grounds having been established at court. Amendment 11 also includes that where a children's hearing considers that it would be appropriate for the child to be transferred from secure accommodation to a YOI, that it must refer the matter to the Scottish ministers. Now, Scottish ministers only have powers to direct the place and conditions for children who have been convicted on indictment in a court of law and where they have been sentenced to detention by the court. The Scottish ministers do not have authority to direct the placement of any other child. Amendment 93 means that where a child aged over 16 years has been charged with or convicted of an offence on indictment, the courts are compelled to commit them to a YOI. So this removes the option of a 16 to 18 year old who has been charged with or convicted of an offence on indictment and remanded being detained in secure accommodation should the court require a suitable place of safety chosen by the local authority, and provides that they can only be detained in YOI. Amendments 94, 96 and 102 extend existing regulation-making powers to provide the circumstances in which children can be transferred to YOIs at the age of 16. This would include children who are convicted and sentenced to detention under summary procedure, which is not possible for a child to be sentenced to detention to a YOI in summary proceedings. Amendments 98 and 100 make provision compelling Scottish ministers to direct that a sentenced child is detained in YOI. Now, the Scottish ministers currently have the power to direct, as I've said, the place and conditions of detention of children under the age of 16, those between 16 and 18 who are subject to a compulsory supervision order, were convicted on indictment and sentenced to detention, and under 18s convicted of murder. Now, where practicable and appropriate, this will be in secure accommodation. However, the option of secure accommodation would be removed. So, as I've outlined, these amendments are regressive from the situation present and would remove the option of secure accommodation for some children. The amendments undoubtedly would be a backward step, turning on its head years of progress in Scotland's approach to youth justice. And as I've said, I'm glad that Ms McCall is not pressing them. And in terms of those other concerns, I would be happy to have a discussion with her ahead of stage three. So I would ask Ms McCall not to press the amendments. If they are pressed, I strongly urge the committee not to reject them.
Double negatives there. We better watch, don't trip up. But thank you. Ros McCall, to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 11, please.
OK. Thank you, Convener. As I've already stated, I'm not going to move these amendments. It will be unacceptable in solemn cases that we move towards a movement restriction condition, in my opinion. And I think it is relevant that we ensure through the process of this bill that we do have adequate residential care, but I'm not moving number 11.
So we'll move them in turn, if that's okay, Ms. McCall. So in terms of Amendment 11?
Not moved. Withdrawn.
So Ros McCall seeks to withdraw Amendment 11. Does any member object? The amendment is therefore withdrawn. I call Amendment 12 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 2. Ros McCall, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. I call Amendment 13 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 2. Minister.
Formally moved.
Okay. The question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
No. Okay. Right, let me just catch my places. We are not agreed on Amendment 13, just checking where we are. So there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 13, please. You got them? Those against? Okay. And then those abstaining? Ms. Duncan-Glancy. Okay. So the result of the vote on Amendment 13 is 4-9 Against, zero, with one abstention. The Amendment 13 is therefore agreed. I now call Amendment 178 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 2. Pam Duncan-Glancy to move or not move?
Moved.
Our voices are all going here. So the question is that Amendment 178 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No, we are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour... I was getting mixed up on this. Sorry, keep me awake. Those against? They're all double checking everything. Thank you. So the result of the vote on Amendment 178 is 4-4. Against, 6, with no abstentions. The Amendment 178 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 14 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 2. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
Okay. I call Amendment 15 in the name of the Minister, already debated. Minister.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Okay, are we ready? So those in favour. Just saw my hand going up and automatically thought it can't go up. Okay. Yep, and those against? And those abstaining. Is that an abstention? Just double checking. Thanks. The result of the vote on Amendment 15 is 4-9, against 0, with one abstention. The Amendment 15 is therefore agreed. So the next question is that Section 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay, thank you. I call Amendment 175 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 2. Pam Duncan-Glancy to move or not move?
Moved, please.
Move. The question is that Amendment 175 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. You ready? Okay. Those in favour of Amendment 175... Those against. Put your hands down now. So the result of the vote on Amendment 175 is 4-4, against 6. Amendment 175 is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 180 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 2. Pam Duncan-Glancy to move or not move? Move. The question is that Amendment 180 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 180... Okay. Those against. The result of the vote on Amendment 180 is 4-4, against 6. The Amendment 180 is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 17 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 2. Minister? Thank you. The question is that Amendment 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No, we are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 17. Okay. All right, you got them all? Okay. And those against? And those abstaining? Okay, thank you. So the result of Amendment 17 is the vote, the result of the vote, in fact, is 4-9, against 0, with one abstention. The Amendment 17 is therefore agreed to. I call Amendment 122 in the name of Willie Rennie, already debated with Amendment 2. Willie Rennie to move or not move?
Moved.
Right. The question is that Amendment 122 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 122. We'll just wait on this one. It's a... Keep your hands up for this. Okay. Wait till Pauline's given me the nod. Those against? Okay. And those abstaining? Two. Okay, so the result of the vote on Amendment 122 is 4-6, against 2, abstentions 2. Amendment 6 is therefore agreed. No, it's too many numbers. Amendment 122 is therefore agreed. Apologies for getting the numbers wrong there. I now call Amendment 181 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy. Already debated with Amendment 2. Pam Duncan-Glancy to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not move. I call Amendment 182 in the name of Willie Rennie. Already debated with 165. Willie Rennie to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 123 in the name of Willie Rennie. Already debated. I'm just checking my list, so I'm not getting it. I call Amendment 123 in the name of Willie Rennie, already debated with Amendment 2. Willie Rennie to move or not move?
Not move.
No. I call Amendment 183 in the name of Willie Rennie, already debated with Amendment 2. Willie Rennie to move or not move?
Not moved.
Okay, thank you. We now move on to the section attendance at children's hearing, and I call Amendment 179 in the name of Russell Finlay in a group on its own. Liam Kerr to move and speak to Amendment 179, please.
Very grateful, convener. Amendment 179 is another in the name of Russell Finlay, which I'll speak to as he's unable to be with us today. Again, put simply, this relates to the principle of transparency, of open justice. Now, as I explained earlier, in relation to Amendment 189, victims' groups have raised serious concerns about an information vacuum in relation to the panel system. And as set out earlier on, more criminal cases will be dealt with by the panel, and that will rise due to the rise in the age. Now, Scotland's courts are public buildings. They are open to the public, and proceedings are conducted, by and large, in public. That is the default position, albeit that there are important safeguards in place. Judges are able, of course, to conduct proceedings in private and issue other orders where relevant in relation to victims and witnesses. But the principle remains, transparency is fundamental to open justice, and that must be cherished. So this amendment seeks to simply extend that transparency to the panel system, which is increasingly dealing with cases of a criminal nature, often serious. But crucially, the amendment caveats that by ensuring that the chair will still be able to refuse attendance where that is in the best interests of the child. And therefore, I move the amendment.
Thank you. Do any other members wish to contribute? No. Minister?
Thank you, Convener. A key function within the children's hearing system is ensuring effective participation from those in the room, and this means the hearing has to be very carefully managed, as reflected in the current rules under Sections 76 to 78 of the Children's Hearing Scotland Act. The chairing member has a duty to minimise the number of the people in the room at any one time to create a more child-friendly setting, which is conducive to the business of the hearing. Amendment 179 would severely obstruct the chairing member's ability to manage a hearing. It has the potential to create extraordinarily challenging situations in the management and operation of hearings, and it would be extremely detrimental to the rights of and well-being of children and their families. Children's hearings, I will take an intervention.
But how does the principle that she's just elaborated stack up against the caveat at subsection 2, allowing the chair to make the appropriate decision in the best interests of the child?
Because something unexpected, in all honesty, something unexpected could happen. The chair doesn't necessarily, I mean, I'm talking about one example here, one situation. Again, it's a case-by-case basis, and every situation would be different. But just because the chair has that initial decision doesn't mean that there could be a difficulty that takes place within the hearing following that decision, based on that decision being made. So I personally don't think that it would be right to allow those decisions to be made. Mr. Kerr referred to open justice and the Scottish courts in his opening for this amendment. But yet again, I would reiterate, the children's hearing system is not a mini court system. It is based on the welfare of the child and the best outcome that would rehabilitate that child. So I'm sorry, but I just don't agree with the premise that allowing what Mr. Kerr is looking for would be cognizant with those aims. Essentially. Now, children's hearings must be conducted in accordance with Article 8 of the ECHR, which requires respect for private and family life. This is why attendance should be restricted to those persons whose presence is necessary for the proper consideration of the case. Furthermore, the UNCRC, supported by all parties, places obligations on children's hearings to uphold every child's right to privacy. No child shall be subjected to arbitrary or unlawful interference with their private and family life. Allowing any member of the public to attend a hearing with no justification would be a regression in children's rights and would be potentially incompatible with those. This amendment fails to consider the fundamental differences between the approach of the children's hearing system and the approach taken by the criminal justice system, as I've just outlined. The amendment does not take account of the fact that the majority of hearings deal with highly sensitive care and protection cases, often for very young and vulnerable children, and they're not simply juvenile courts dealing with young offenders. On the basis that this approach would disregard the child's wellbeing, rights and their best interests, as reflected in the legislation as it currently stands, I cannot support Amendment 179. I would ask the member not to press it to a vote, but if he does, I strongly urge the committee to reject it.
Liam Kerr, to wind up, press or withdraw the Amendment 179, please.
Well, I've listened very carefully to what the Minister has to say. And the Minister says she doesn't agree with the premise of the amendment, but the premise of open justice and transparency is core. And I've also put in, or Russell Findlay has put in, very clearly, yes, I will.
Just to correct the member, I did not say I didn't agree with the premise. I said I didn't agree with the premise in relation to the children's hearing system, which is not a mini court.
We can both look at the official record afterwards for what I noted down when the minister was speaking. But the caveat that I've put in to, or that Russell Findlay's put in to this amendment, is clear and unequivocal. It gives the chair appropriate jurisdiction over the hearing that the chair presides over. And that utterly destroys the minister's argument that there is in some way an erosion of rights. And therefore, convener, I press the amendment in Russell Findlay's name.
The question is that Amendment 179 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 179. Those against. Keep your fork up, please. Okay. So the result of a vote on Amendment 179 is 4, 1, against 9. The amendment is not agreed. I'm now going to move to reporting restrictions, the grouping offences and penalties. And I call Amendment 16 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendments 25, 43, 52 and 84. Minister, can you move Amendment 16 and speak to all amendments in the group, please?
Thank you, Convener. Sections 12 and 13 of the Bill already make a range of provisions in respect of reporting restrictions in cases involving children, whether that be as victims, witnesses or suspects. Such cases often attract high levels of media and public interest, and the implications of breaching reporting restrictions for the children involved can be significant. Now, this group of government amendments makes further provision for offences and penalties in response to breaches of reporting restrictions, both in relation to the children's hearing and in relation to the criminal justice system. Amendment 16 increases the maximum penalties for a breach of a reporting restriction in relation to a children's hearing case. This increases the maximum penalty on summary conviction to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 12 months, or a fine not exceeding the statutory maximum, or both. On conviction on indictment, the maximum penalty is increased to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 2 years, or a fine, or both. This is for consistency with the changes made in Amendments 43 and 84, which cover breaches of reporting restrictions before court or during or after court proceedings, respectively. They make the same increase to maximum penalties for breaches of reporting restrictions in the criminal justice system as Amendment 16 does for the hearing system. Now, breaching reporting restrictions is an offence, therefore increasing the maximum penalties for breaching such restrictions recognises the severity of that. And these changes also reflect stakeholders' stage one evidence that the current level of penalty does not serve as a sufficient deterrent to the potential gains from doing so, which can be significant. Yes.
I'm very grateful to the Minister to give way, and I am very supportive of the proposals that are set out here, but one of the challenges the Minister will be aware is how this information is disseminated, particularly by people who may be close to a young person in the system. And is she content that, as the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011 makes reference to the Broadcasting Act 1990, which obviously is reserved, that there is sufficient control of social media in the same sort of TikTok, Facebook, that it would be covered to amount to a broadcast that would allow a potential breach to be investigated and indeed pursued?
I will get on to some of the difficulties around this, but I would agree with a lot of what the member says in terms of social media. I think there are certainly gaps there. I think that kind of serves across a whole range of issues with social media. So I think that's certainly something that might have to be monitored and looked at going forward in relation to this, as with, again, other difficulties with social media. But I'll get on to some of the issues. So Amendment 16 increases the maximum penalties for a breach of reporting restriction in relation to a children's hearings case, and this increases the maximum penalty on summary conviction to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 12 months. Oh, sorry, I am repeating myself. I've lost my place. Apologies for that. Breaching reporting restrictions is an offence. Therefore, increasing the maximum penalties for breaching such restrictions recognises the severity and reflects stakeholders' Stage 1 evidence. Now, Amendments 43 and 84 also provide appropriate statutory defences for breaches of reporting restrictions, and this is to avoid unfairly criminalising individuals or publishers for the sharing of already published information when they had no reason to know or suspect the original publication was done unlawfully or did not know that it included relevant information. Now, again, these concerns were raised by stakeholders at Stage 1, and it reflects the realities of social media and brings greater consistency with existing children's hearings legislation and provisions in other UK jurisdictions in respect of court proceedings. However, as I've already stated to Ms. Whitfield, this is something that I think needs to be continued to be monitored. Now, these amendments also clarify individual culpability where an organisation commits an offence for breaches of reporting restrictions pre-court and during and after court proceedings respectively. This provides a further disincentive to committing the offence of breaching reporting restrictions. Amendment 43 also has the effect that the Crown cannot be found criminally liable for the offence created by Section 106BB1. However, through the mechanism in subsection 2, any unlawful conduct on the part of Crown bodies can be declared unlawful by the Court of Session, and this is consistent with existing legal provision and usual practice. Now, these changes also seek to bring greater consistency and reflect the proposals in the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill, which is currently progressing through Parliament, noting the committee's comments in the Stage 1 report regarding alignment between provision in the two bills, as well as with penalties under contempt of court legislation. They're also important because the bill provisions will also apply to a broader range of potential publishers, including publishers operating outside frameworks of professional regulation like the Editor's Code or Ofcom regulations. Amendments 25 and 52 are consequential amendments. So, yes, I will.
Does the Minister have any concern that these amendments could have a restriction on press freedom?
No. I think I would say that they set out with we had an intended aim that we set out for with these amendments. I think I've spoke to that perfectly. I think I've explained the premise behind them. And I think if there was any danger of that, then I would not be taking them forward as is. So, no. I move Amendment 16 and I would ask members to support it and the other amendments in this group.
Okay, thank you, Minister. Anyone? Okay, pass. Right, so the question is that Amendment 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. So, you ready? Okay. Those in favour? Okay. And those against? Okay, the result of the vote on Amendment 16 is for 8, against 2. The amendment is therefore agreed to. The next question is that Section 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I now call Amendment 184 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 2. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move? Not move. Thank you. I now move to the next grouping on legal aid, and I call Amendment 185 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy, group with Amendment 186. Pam Duncan Glancy to move Amendment 185 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. My amendments in this group support the principle that anyone subject to proceedings on either welfare or offence grounds should have access to legal representation on the basis that the outcome of such proceedings may have a significant impact on their life. Legal aid plays a pivotal role in addressing the inherent inequalities that can arise during legal proceedings. Children entangled in the children's hearing system may come from diverse socioeconomic backgrounds or difficult family circumstances. Legal aid can level the playing field, ensuring that every child has the means to present their case effectively and comprehensively and understands fully the process they're involved in. This inclusivity is aligned with the principles of justice and fairness that underpin the legal system. Many, including the Children's Commissioner, have consistently called for extension of legal aid to children in all circumstances, and the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child has made a number of recommendations to this effect, most recently in their 2023 concluding observations. And we know that organisations supporting children's rights have come across situations where a young person has not understood that accepting under Section 67(2)(j) grounds can result in them effectively having a conviction on their PVG record. The emotional and psychological toll of navigating the legal system can be overwhelming for all young people moving through it, and the committee's own report recognised that, which is why my amendment 186 would give all children undergoing proceedings, regardless of the grounds on which they've been referred, to have a statutory right to access legal aid. In my view, the protection of that right in legislation would provide a fundamental safeguard for children's rights and is essential to create a system that is fair and just, ensures children are not left unsupported and is compliant with the UNCRC, and so I urge members to support my amendments today.
Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 186, as we've heard, would make children's legal aid automatically available to every child subject to a children's hearing fixed by the children's reporter, including all deferred hearings, irrespective of the grounds of referral. And while I can see the intention to ensure legal representation when it is needed and appropriate, this is already in place. This amendment risks bringing an overly adversarial approach into the system when we have a successful national advocacy scheme, and advocates can also draw on legal advice where needed. According to the Scottish Children's Reporter Administration's annual report, 22,341 children's hearings took place in the year 22-23. The effect of this amendment operationally would be to require that the SCRA notify the Scottish Legal Aid Board of every hearing. SLAB would then in turn have to arrange for a duty solicitor to be made available to every subject child, assuming that the subject child did not already have a solicitor of choice. To establish if every subject child already had a solicitor for every hearing taking place under the Children's Hearing Scotland Act would be a logistical impossibility given the number of hearings, and it is simply unnecessary. I'd be grateful if I could continue with my speaking note, and I'm happy to answer any questions at the end because there's quite a lot of kind of technical information in here. So automatic provision of legal aid has been targeted to circumstances where hearings are convened in certain circumstances or proceed before a sheriff. Otherwise, a type of legal aid known as assistance by way of representation, or ABWR, is available for every child subject to a children's hearing, subject to an application to SLAB that addresses a means and merits test. Now, as a child is unlikely to have any financial resources, the means test is nearly always met. Likewise, the merits test, which was one of effective participation, is also nearly always met. SLAB reports a high grant rate for ABWR applications on behalf of children, and this was 99% over the last 12 months. A child's social worker or advocacy worker can assist the child with securing contact with a solicitor to make an application for ABWR, and every child subject has a right to advocacy support. So it should be borne in mind that children's hearings adopt a welfareist approach which aims to be non-adversarial in nature. And while the children's panel takes legally binding decisions, it is not an appropriate forum for detailed legal argument and instead is centred around the needs of the child who has been referred to the hearing. It's therefore not expected or desirable that publicly funded legal representation be automatically available in every hearing, or would it necessarily be required? Amendment 185 again seeks to extend the availability of automatic children's legal aid to any occasion when a referral ground includes an offence allegedly being committed. And while I do accept that this is narrower in scope than Amendment 186, I am again concerned about the need for such a blanket provision when there is currently adequate scope under the current rules for children to have access to legal aid where it is required. As already mentioned, ABWAR is already available for all hearings to the subject child by way of application to SLAB with that very high grant rate. And moreover, Section 28C of the 1D of the Legal Aid Scotland Act 1986 already allows for automatic children's legal aid to be provided for children's hearings to which Section 69(3) of the 2011 Act applies. This is where a hearing is arranged by the children's reporter in relation to a child who is being kept in a place of safety, having allegedly committed a criminal offence. This amendment would also result in automatic children's legal aid for any hearing in which there was a minor offence as a ground of referral, and there may be a number of grounds. It's understood that last year 2,637 children were referred to the reporter on offence grounds, although not all of those will have resulted in hearings. Operationally, this amendment would result in a significant number of duty appointments being required to be put in place by SLAB, along with the knock-on effect for those solicitors currently on the duty list. I'm just finished closing up and then I would be happy to. The Hearings for Children redesign report recommended further exploration of the mechanisms for children to access legal aid, and this work will be undertaken by the statutory bodies responsible and overseen by the Children's Hearings Redesign Board in the course of 24. It's anticipated this will entail significant further work with social work, local authorities, the SLAB and the wider legal professions representatives, including the Law Society of Scotland. So I would urge the member not to press amendments 185 and 186, and if they are pressed, I would urge the committee to reject them, given the reasons I've outlined.
Before Pam Duncan-Glancy, I know there's members at this side that may have questions. Mr Kerr, do you have anything you wish to ask the Minister?
Yeah, just very briefly. The Minister said that it was a logistical impossibility, but does she worry that she's then putting logistics over ensuring representation?
I don't agree with Mr Kerr, no, because as I've outlined in my comments, the ability for children to access legal aid is already there. I think this puts unnecessary duplication of work into these organisations, and I don't find it's required.
Ms Ruth Maguire, before I...
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you helpfully laid out there in detail what is available. I think that was certainly helpful to hear, but committee did hear about, you know, a potential issue with children accepting offence grounds without maybe understanding what repercussions that would have for later life. So the example was given that if a child's in trouble and they accept the offence grounds, the support and intervention is going to go in, so it can feel like the best thing to do, and you know, often it will be. I'm not making a judgment on that, but I think there has been a potential issue identified. Whilst the answer might not be in the blanket approach of legal aid, would you commit to having a further look at just, you know, at that problem that has been highlighted to the committee, and it may be that there's something within the existing system that could be tweaked that would make it better for children who are accepting offence grounds.
I thank Ruth Maguire for that intervention, and yes, I absolutely agree. If there's issues there, they need to be looked at, and that's something that I'd certainly be happy to look into, especially given the further work that's going to be getting done around this in relation to the Hearings for Children report. So, absolutely, but I just, again, agree with the member that this blanket approach isn't necessarily the best way forward, but if there are children falling through those gaps, then that's something that needs to be looked at.
Before I come to Pam Duncan-Glancy.
It was the same question as Ruth Maguire.
Okay, actually. Thank you very much, Mr Greer. Pam Duncan-Glancy, thank you very much. Can you wind up, and also if you've got a question, you can, and perhaps the Minister might respond in your statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. On Amendment 185, the Minister, and I'm slightly confused because in some of the reasons that the Minister sets out not to support these. On one hand, the Minister is setting out a range of measures that are available and saying there's already support in place. And on the other, the Minister is saying it would be unwieldy to meet those requirements. So it's either close to being able to be met in terms of putting this into legislation and giving people a right to it, or it's so far from. I think those two positions do somewhat contradict themselves. Amendment 185, I think, to speak with to Ruth's point, Ruth Maguire's point, forgive me, convener and colleague, to speak to Ruth Maguire's point, I think it's important that we address some of the issues and the gaps that were highlighted to us. That's what this amendment sought to do. It sought, at least in 185, to extend legal aid availability, incidentally, so not necessarily the delivery of it, or indeed the availability of a lawyer in that space at that time, but to extend legal aid availability, should it be required, to the young person, particularly to address the gaps that my colleague Ruth Maguire highlighted and that I highlighted in my opening remarks around specific offences, for example, in Section 67. I will.
If you don't mind, can you let the committee member carry on? Thanks.
I'm sorry, colleague. On that basis, I think there are gaps that do need to be looked at here. And I take the minister said, I heard the minister talk about some minor offences. I think if anything, no matter how minor, is going to be going to lead to potentially a conviction which can appear on someone's PVG, I think they should have access to legal aid at this point. I think that principle is really important. Would the minister be prepared to work with me and possibly other members who've indicated on Amendment 185 to look to see if there is something we can do specifically? On Amendment 186, because of the reason that sometimes a young person can appear to a panel, this was put to us, that a young person can appear to a panel on a welfare grounds, and through the conversation that happens through that panel, it can appear that there has been some criminality. That was what Amendment 186 sought to address. I don't hear any indication that the Minister is willing to consider extending to welfare grounds, but I would appreciate if the Minister could respond to potentially working with me and others on at least Amendment 185 on offence grounds.
I've been very clear that I'd be happy to look into that further and work with members around that. Yes, I absolutely. However, I think in terms of the amendments as the way they stand, and sorry, Ms Duncan Glancy raised quite a number of points there. For the reasons that I have previously given, I don't think that they would provide the what the member is essentially looking for with this. I don't think it would necessarily cover that. I think it would create a large, as I say, duplication of work. And just in relation to what you were talking about around minor offences, if the offence is quite minor and there are lots of grounds on welfare, for example, a solicitor could be seen as adversarial at that point. Really, we want to create a system where the child is at the centre and they have they currently have the ability to access legal aid. But as I say, I would be more than happy to work on, not at this point, no, I would be more than happy to work with members around some of the gaps and the children that may be falling through the gaps in relation to that.
For that, and on that basis, I may consider not pressing Amendment 185. I think Amendment 186 is still important. To have that discussion around the extending legal rights in other areas because of the reasons that I mentioned earlier on. And I would urge committee members to support 186 when it comes to the point that we vote on that amendment.
So thank you. We'll take each in turn. Ms Pam Duncan Clancy, are you pressing or withdrawing 185?
On the basis of the commitment to work with us, I will withdraw 185.
Thank you. And can I call... Pam Duncan Clancy seeks to withdraw Amendment 185, and does any member object? No. Thank you. That amendment is withdrawn. I call Amendment 186 in the name of Pam Duncan Clancy, already debated with Amendment 185. Pam Duncan Clancy to move or not move?
I move.
Not move?
Move.
Sorry, move. Sorry, apologies.
Let's go.
The question is that Amendment 186... be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. No. Okay. We are not agreed, and there will be a division. So those in favour of Amendment 186. You got us? And those against? Okay, thank you. The result of the vote on Amendment 186 is 4-4, against 6. The Amendment 186 is therefore not agreed. Can I now call Amendment 187, again in the name of Pam Duncan Clancy, already debated with Amendment 169. Pam Duncan Clancy, to move or not move?
Moved.
Move. The question is that Amendment 187 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 187. Okay. Those against. So the result of the vote on Amendment 187 is 4-4 against 6. Amendment 187 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 188 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 169. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Move.
Okay, thank you. The question is that Amendment 188 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, okay. We are not agreed, so there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 188. Those against. The result of the vote on Amendment 188 is 4-4 against 6. Therefore, Amendment 188 is not agreed to. The next question is that Section 8.210 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. I now call Amendment 18 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 3. Ros McCall, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Again, I call Amendment 19 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 3. Ros McCall, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 189 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 3. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
Because the principle the government opposes is supported by Victim Support Scotland, the legal basis is dubious at best from the Minister and drafting ambiguities can be cleared at stage three, I press Amendment 189.
Okay. You're moving question at 189. Okay, thank you. So the next question is that Amendment 189 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of 189. Those against. And abstentions? Okay. The result of the vote on Amendment 189 is 4-4, against 5, abstentions 1. The Amendment 189 is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 190 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 3. Liam Kerr, to move or not move?
It's 190.
The question is that... Amendment 190 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
No, we are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those Those against? Those abstaining? We're keeping the clerks on their toes with all this. Yeah, 5 minutes. Right. The result of the vote on Amendment 190 is 4-1, against 7, abstentions 2. Amendment 190 is therefore not agreed to. The question next question is that Section 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. Can I suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to give everyone a brief comfort break, if that's okay? I've had a few people requesting that. 5 minutes max. Okay? Thank you. Thank you very much. We've recommenced the meeting, but I think in discussion during that small comfort break, we've had a look at what's ahead of us in terms of the various sections, and we've made the decision to suspend the meeting today and the deliberations of the bill at stage two. And we are at, so when we come back, we will start next week at section 12, which is the section on reporting restrictions and self-identification. So that concludes our consideration of the bill at stage two today, and we will continue with its consideration, as I've just outlined, on our next meeting on the 31st of January. And I will now close the meeting. Thank you for everyone's time this morning.